it isn't going to be easy. I'm going to need all the help I can get, to be honest with you.
As long as the water's wobbly and I can get a lead through it, then I have every chance of catching a carp, so that's exactly what I want to do.
31 pounds of scaly, long as you like, mirror carp.
No one has ever blanked on a carper's paradise holiday, as I'm feeling this fish grating through rocks now. That's tired of playing me mind a bit.
There's always something to be learned with carp fishing. I think that's the beauty of it.
Yes! February, freezing cold, winter fishing, and I've got something here a little bit special.
I can't help myself. Light my fire. That was absolutely fantastic. Hello and welcome to Carp Fishing Edges Volume 4, the latest in Fox's DVD series. And it hardly seems like yesterday that I was introducing 3.5. For the past 7 months, the team has been faced with a whole host of new venues and scenarios to bring you an action-packed film. We're here today at RK Leisure's Raisbury 1, a very, very historic water. And whilst I try and sort out a carp from here, we're going back to last September and we're going to Farriers Lake in Gloucestershire, where I'm attempting to outwit one or two of its residents. Hello and welcome to the Cotswolds, and more specifically Farriers Lake, run by the Carp Society. A lake that I've had a ticket for a couple of years now. I just fish it normally a little bit in the spring and a little bit in the autumn. And what an incredible lake it is. It's full of huge commons. Most of them are over 30 pound with a good scattering over 40. There's a small group of mirrors that are hugely sought after in here as well. So the fishing is hugely interesting. Apart maybe from the last 3 or 4 days when I think one or two fish have been caught and the fishing has slowed down terribly. My timing couldn't have been worse. You join me 24 hours into probably a 72 hour session. And to say it's grim is probably an understatement. But I have a theory. As long as I have a bait in the water, there's every chance that I'm going to catch a fish. I reeled in early this morning after bite time. I've been up to the shops, replenished my supplies, and hopefully having my lines out of the water for 4 or 5 hours, I've given the chance for the fish to move around a little bit, unencumbered with lines lying all over the top of the weed. I'm gonna reposition those rods now. I'm gonna put a couple of spots of bait out there, not a lot because I don't think they're eating a lot, and then I'm gonna sit down, have a cup of tea, and cross my fingers and any other part of my body that will willingly be crossed. Well, I am connected all to a carp. The problem is, as most of us, oh my goodness, gracious me, the weed is the problem. Slowly, inch by inch. There it is, solid as a rock, unfortunately. Damn! That's a lovely feeling. All the rain's got into my chest, ladies. I'm going into the pond, I may be some time.
got ourselves a rather nice common carp. It's probably going to take me about a week to get this weed out of my landing net. And as soon as I do, we'll take a look at what's in it.
It's actually a very good fish. Always amazes me just how much a carp can cheer up the life of a carp fisherman. Absolutely amazing. First thing I do, get all his fins flush to his body. Oh, all right, mate. Well, my opening piece of this section might have sounded a little bit gloomy, and I think we all suffer with that every now and again. It can almost seem impossible, but like I said, as long as I've got a hook bait in the water, there's every chance I'm going to catch myself a carp. What I didn't expect was after repositioning the hook baits for it to take off after, 25, 30 minutes, but that's carp fishing. That's the kind of thing that can happen. That's what keeps us coming back for more. And whether it's whether I took the lines out of the water to go up to the shop and rested the swim for 5 or 6 hours, I've got no idea. But I tend to think it helps. And if that helps my confidence, then there's every chance I'm going to catch myself a carp that looks just like this. Oof. 33 pound and 15 ounces, and as you would have seen from the fight, weed is a problem. It's a problem everywhere now with the restrictions on controlling it, so you've got to make sure your tackle is man enough to land the fish and get them through it. Mine did, as it always does, and what we're going to do now is we're going to get a few stills of this stunning fish, get her back in the pond. I'll reposition the hook bait, and you never know, we might just get another one. I've had a ticket for Farriers now for 18 months. I didn't fish it as soon as I got the ticket. I wanted the water for the autumn, and this was it. I had absolutely no idea how productive it could be, and I caught an absolute cartload of 30 pound commons over 10 sessions. Most of them were 2 or 3 days long, topped by a lake record of 46 pound and 10 ounces, and it really, really doesn't get any better than that. I did a little bit this spring. I'm not a great lover of July and August, so I stayed away. I've come back in September. It's not as productive as it was, but it's made the fishing interesting, and yes, it's been a wonderful experience and a real joy to fish here. The rigs that I use, I only use two. I use a bottom bait rig, 6 inches of strippable braid, a liner adapter, a size 7 or 8 SSC hook, a fairly long hair that gives me good separation from the hook, and the hook bait. And I normally, I always use it in conjunction with a PVA bag. I also use a stiff link pop-up. I do that because I think it's probably the most effective rig to use over a spread of boilers. I don't use it over if I'm using any pellets or predominantly small baits, but if I've got a good spread of 15 mil boilers out there, then I will have a 15 mil pop-up over the top. And as the saying goes, it works for me. I don't change technical things if I can possibly help it, but obviously the materials that I use help me construct the rigs that I want to create and hopefully improve the mechanics of it. No, I can't think of one specific thing that, the liner adapters, anti-tangle sleeves, the different textures in strippable braids all help to create the presentation that I want. But probably the biggest thing is the ready tide chod rigs. And they've amazed me that that somebody can tie rigs that are all exactly the same length and are absolutely perfect. And of all the technical things I use, they're probably the greatest thing that I've changed in my own fishing. I don't tie the pop-up section of my stiff links anymore. The sun's just dipped over the horizon, and the temperature, unsurprisingly, for late September is plummeting quite rapidly, but I'm very, very confident of more fish. I repositioned both rods after I had that 33 earlier on this afternoon, and I'm not going to redo them before dark. You see a lot of people redo them at dark and first lights, probably times when you're most likely to get a bite. So they went down with a thump. They are exactly where I want them to be. A couple more spots of bait just to freshen those spots up, and hopefully any passing carp are going to have a little bit of interest. I'm going to have a couple of cups of tea now, watch the light fall out of the sky, get my head down, and hopefully the next time I see you, I'll be holding a whacking great big carp. It's the morning after the very uneventful night before. Not a lot happened in the night. There was the odd bleat, which could quite easily have been bats bumping into my line for all I know. I heard and saw nothing in the times that I was awake. But things changed up a little bit this morning. The liner started shortly after first light, which was nice to see. And I think there were probably fish in and around that spot. I think what's happened though is they've broken up into much smaller groups. And until I get a few fish over those spots competing for the food, I'm probably not gonna get the bites. We did see a fish about 45 minutes, an hour ago, show right over the left-hand rod, but nothing came of it. I did have one occurrence where the bobbin pulled up tight. I had to reel the rod in and obviously see if there was anything there. There wasn't. But at least there's some kind of activity. I've spoken to one angler this morning, a little bit further down the lake, and he has seen absolutely nothing. However, there's enough going on here to make me want to stay. I've got the rods in now. I'll get them all ready to rock and roll for a little bit later on, but I want to use that time while I'm resting the swim. I don't want to sit on my bed chair and read a book or whatever and listen to the radio. I want to use that time to my advantage. Go and talk to other anglers on the lake, see if anything else has happened, and also see if I can spot anything that I can capitalize on and move on to. If I don't, then I'm back here and we'll get the rods back out, and again, we'll cross every part of our body if we can and hope we get another carp. And so to the rig I've been using so effectively here at Farriers for the past couple of months. There's a couple of rules here that are ardently adhered to, and the last thing I want to do is break any of those. And the first one is there's no leaders to be used here of any kind. That's casting leaders, snag leaders, leg core leaders, whatever you want to call them. You just have to use your main line all the way through. And I'm very lucky to be able to use trans-khaki fluorocarbon main line. I use it in 16 pound, and it really is man enough for the job in weedy waters. It's been great with all the fish that I've hooked here. I've been able to get them through that weed and with no damage to the line either, so that's one real bonus. Okay, the way that I set this up then, obviously no leader. The first thing I do is run a tapered mainline stopper up the mainline itself and cover that with a little tapered bead, and that's going to stop the rig flying up the mainline, and I can stop it at whatever depth I think it needs to be relevant to the bottom I'm fishing over. The next thing to do is to run a flexi ring swivel up the main line, and I put the large ring of the swivel on the main line so it's big enough to go over anything that might get connected to the main line should there be a breakage. Next up, I run a chod heli buffer sleeve up the main line, and it's there to protect the main line from the metal on the swivel. If you don't put something there, that swivel could easily cut through your main line. Certainly under the pressure you're going to put that line under in weedy conditions. And finally, the lead itself. Now, to ensure that sleeve doesn't come off, I leave the swivel on so there's plenty of swivel for it to grip hold of, and a little bit of silicone tubing. It just makes sure that swivel stays absolutely where I want it to be. And that's the lead setup. I use a 3¼ ounce lead, and I use that probably for 95% of my fishing wherever I go, at whatever range I'm fishing at. I think flat pair leads add to the shock effect of any rig, and I like them. Obviously for ultimate distances I may change that, but that is 95% of my fishing. And on to the hook link. This is my version of a stiff link pop-up. I know there are several, but this is the one that's worked for me on every water I've cast out in. The first thing is the boom section, 5 or 6 inches long, and it's made of 30 pound illusion fluorocarbon. It's very, very stiff, and it's very, very tough. One end goes to the hook link swivel itself, and I tie that with a simple overhand knot. It may be simple, but it's very, very effective in this stiff material, and it's never let me down. I leave a loop of maybe 3/4 of an inch, and that gives some kind of lateral movement to the rig itself. It almost gives it another half a dimension, and I'm sure it helps with the effectiveness and the mechanics of the rig. And then to the swivel itself and the chod rig. It is actually a chod rig, although I don't use them in that condition. I use it for the uplink of my stiff link pop-ups. And for the first time in my life, I'm using rigs that somebody else has tied. I never ever thought they would happen, but they are so good and so effective. This is a size 5 SR hook to which I've attached my normal little pop-up arrangement. I can't really give you an answer, but for donkey's years I've always put a little added bit of buoyancy on top of the pop-ups. It may be a sight bob, I'm not that certain that sight is so important to a carp, but it gives me confidence, so it's always going to be there. And that's it basically. Storing the rigs themselves, I take them out of the packaging and I put them in a chod bin. One that allows me, there's three different variations of the curve you can get, and I like the sharpest curve possible, and it allows me to have everything ready to rock and roll and out of the packaging, and I can do it as quickly as possible. And finally, just to keep that curve in your hook link, if you're on the move, packing up or whatever, get your hook and put it back through the flexi ring swivel. One, it stops it catching on anything, pulling it and losing the curve in the hook link, and it also keeps that curve in it. And once you get to its other end, pop it out, cast it out in the pond, and over a scat and a boilies, I think that's the best rig possible. Recast my rods. The winds died down quite considerably from when I tried to reposition them earlier on today, but they needed to be out there through that bite time, and I'd rather have a bait out there that I wasn't quite sure about while the carp may be feeding than have nothing there at all. We went through that period, it's so windy, whether I was getting any liners, that we didn't see any fish. So I've repositioned them, I've got about 14 hours left, and this really is the last roll of the dice. I have to remember that yesterday afternoon I caught a 33 pound 15 ounce common carp, and they are still such impressive animals even in a world of big carp. And what I'm trying to say there is a lot of people will, you know, that'll do. They don't want to disturb the water by casting a few more times. And I'd rather cast 50 times and know that that is presented absolutely perfect, especially if it's going to stay out there for 14, 15 hours, than mess about with two or three casts and that'll do. No, sometimes it won't do. It has to be as you want it, or you're just not going to have the confidence levels, and you're just not going to be happy with your fishing. Yes, I've caught a very, very nice common carp. I wouldn't have like another. Absolutely the 11th hour stuff. I was just sat there having a brew, and I thought it's absolutely stuck fast in the weed. I've seen more in the past 10 minutes than I've seen for the past 2 days, and this is absolutely stuck in there. I'm considering, if I knew where a bailiff was, I'm gonna get it. What to do? I need a bailiff now, if I want that boat. Oh, this is awful. There is a boat on site, but you can't use it without a bailiff, and thankfully Bob the bailiff, who's just trundling in behind me in the boat, was standing on a far bank with a bit of hand waving, a bit of shouting. He's brought the boat over, so I can go out after the fish, which probably is quite exciting viewing for you, but I will be doing so with my heart in my mouth. It's a very fraught situation, but here we go. We're going to see if we can bag him. It's unbelievable. I've been stood here, even while I've been playing this fish, I've probably seen more fish showing than I have in all the time I've been here. So, yeah, somebody's going to have a bit of a beano when I've disappeared, but we'll go and see if we can find him. How you doing, Bob? So, it's a 21 pound 6 ounce mirror, and to a lot of people that just might be standard fare, but to me, when one in 25 of the fish I've caught out of Farriers is a mirror, this is truly exciting. He's a real old boy, he's got a few scars on him, and he's obviously been round the block a few times, and it means the world to me. You can't odds what's going to pick your upbait up when you've cast it 60, 70 yards out in the lake, but to catch such a rare fish as this is a real honour. What an absolute character, and as I say, a proper old boy. This week has probably been the worst I've known here, but to end it with a very rare mirror carp is a real honour, and thank you very much, sir. And to get a boat battle in as well, just to make things a little bit more exciting, was pretty cool too. Absolutely fantastic. No better way. And always great to have that last lingering look at your prize and slip him off back to fight another day. Thank you so much. You've made all the effort very, very worth it. Go on. Well, I can't help myself. Light my fire. That was absolutely fantastic. I'm not often one for excuses. Things happen because they happen, but it has been the toughest week at Farriers anybody can remember for quite a long time. I think things are just about to change here. Fish are starting to show, and they're obviously starting to get caught. It's been tough, it's been hard, but that's one of the vagaries of carp fishing. That's what keeps us coming back for more, and that's why I'll be back here next week for a little bit more of the same. Wow. Absolutely amazing. And I've hooked one straight away. Wow. All in all, I was absolutely over the moon with that result. And I'm pretty over the moon at the moment because I'm actually playing a carp at Raisbury, which is absolutely incredible. And next up for you though, is the challenge where Harry sets Mark his biggest task to date.
I'm Mark Pitchers, wader-wearing, tea-drinking, beer-trimming carp freak. I've been an angler for over 30 years and I've caught carp from waters far and wide, big and small. For me, it doesn't matter where, as long as the challenge is exciting and inspiring. But now the tables have turned and it's over to you, the public, to assign my next mission on Fox's Facebook page.
It's not exactly the easiest challenge, is it?
Rivers and lakes, rigs and baits.
You fell to the cat meat.
There's been a number of incredibly tough challenges during this series. Have you been drinking de-icer again? Some of which I've knocked out the park.
Challenge completed.
Others have dealt me a devastating blow. But I'm still here and ready to pick up any gauntlet that is thrown down. This carp freak is not giving up without a fight. This is the challenge. Good evening. What's up, carp freaks? It's challenge time again. As you can see, I'm at home and Harry has driven up especially to give me my instructions for our second feature length challenge special. I've got next week booked in for the filming, so that gives us 6 days to plan for this one. Last time round, I kind of smashed out the park with a night left to spare. And I kind of joked that it was all a little bit too easy. And I'm kind of hoping they've forgotten all about that and they won't try and stitch me up too much this time round. So I guess all that's left for me to say is, Harry, can I have my challenge?
Okay.
You want to go down, Bert? Go on, big fella. Right. Okay. You have 4 nights to catch 3 carp from 3 different venues One has to be from a lake, one from a canal, and one from a river. Oh, and don't forget your passport, because they also need to be from three different countries. Good luck. Ooh, yeah. Ooh.
What do you think?
I thought you were being overly kind, giving me like 6 days to prepare, and now I kind of see why, and I don't think it's too kind at all.
No.
The lake, yeah, fair enough. Yeah. The lake, that I can think of a few lakes where I can get one quite quickly.
You can't, they have to be non-commercial public lakes, basically. That we didn't put that, that's in small print.
Yeah. Okay, that changes things a little bit, doesn't it? Oh. Yeah.
Do you know any public lakes?
No, not really. I don't really fish abroad at all. I've only been like a handful of times ever. I very rarely go abroad. Luckily though, we've got a few overseas consultants that I know well enough to be able to ring, and I know they can give me some info. I'm gonna need all the help I can get, to be honest with you. It isn't going to be easy, but yeah, I'm going to have to kind of put a lot of my faith and trust into other people. So yeah, I feel like I best get planning now, really.
Yeah, I'll see you in a week.
Yeah, see you next week. Cheers. Well, here we are down in Essex, where I've come to collect Harry, who is my wingman on this epic European adventure. The van's all loaded, and what we need to do now, we need to head over to Folkestone to catch the tunnel. This is very much a race against the clock. We need to leave the country quickly. Harry's already set us behind schedule because he insisted on having a pajazzle this morning. He always has to copy. So, come on, Harry, let's get a move on. We need to get going. I like that. I like that. That's what I'm talking about.
Living in a town like you're swinging a gun. Just a small town dude with a big city attitude.
Harry, I keep telling you, people keep likening us to Ross and Rachel out of Friends. But I like to, it's like, will they, won't they? Yeah, they will, but it might just take time. But I like to think it was more of like Scott and Charlene from Neighbours back in the 80s. Was it 90s? Well, this was the song they walked down the aisle to. This was their wedding song. And you know it. Stop pretending you didn't know that. Part of me wanting to know every part of you. Well, here we are on the crossing to France. Got 37 minutes, I'm all pick and mixed up, and I thought I will give you a little bit of a briefing on how I see this challenge unfolding. Like I say, we're over on our way to France, where I'm meeting up with John Baptiste. He is one of our French consultants. I spoke to him last week regarding possible venues, and he's put me onto a really good lake, not too far from Calais, a couple hours from Calais, over on the coast. I don't really know a great deal about the venue. He has given me the coordinates, and I did a bit of Google Earthing, and there was that many waters in that area, I didn't really know which one it is we're going to be fishing. But he did say I'd need a boat, so I'm guessing it's going to be on quite a sizable water.
He also says there's a very good chance that we could get this one done quite quickly. He said it's not easy, but there's a chance we can get a bite in our first night on the venue. So that would be good, because this is going to be a race against the clock. We only have kind of 3 days of actual fishing time here. We've got a day of sort of travelling, half a day either way. So yeah, the way I look at it, I can't afford to spend more than 24 hours in one country if I'm going to pass this. It's very much in the hands of the gods. If we have a slight mishap, either traffic or anything, I don't know, weather related, then I think this challenge will be dead in the water. So yeah, let's hope this all goes well. I'm going to finish my pick and mix and I'll see you on the other side.
That's it there.
Is that it?
That's his bat.
Is it? That's yeah. Sure?
Yeah.
That peep?
Yeah, no, that's it.
Are you sure? Is he Belgian? Well, here we are. We've arrived at last. I can see a little bit of the lake from where we've parked. Jean-Baptiste is already here. I'm feeling a little bit intimidated. Not by Jean-Baptiste. He's a lovely fellow. But by the lake. It's, I can only see a very, very small bit of water through like the gap in the trees here. And what I'm looking at here is probably pushing 100 acres. And the lake goes a long way in that direction and a long way in that direction. So it's a massive, massive dollop of water. I hope Jean-Baptiste kind of knows what he's doing here. I don't know what he thinks I am. I'm not some sort of Euro globe-trotting carbon adventurer. But this is a big old bit of water. Can you tell I'm a little bit panicky, Harry?
Yeah.
Right, let's go and find him.
Let's
see what his story is.
It does look good, doesn't it?
Yeah. What's the best way to greet a Frenchman?
I don't know. What are you going to do?
I don't know. I just go for the arse grab. Bonjour! Good to see you. How are you doing? Good to meet you, at last. This looks awesome.
It's huge.
Yeah?
Yes.
Absolutely, yes. All them gravel workings, it looks yes. Brilliant.
Yes.
Oh, it's huge.
That's the smallest part. And it's also going to the other side now, basically.
Oh, it goes around there as well?
Yes. Yeah, I think nearly there, like a little canal, but it's going to be twice of that in 10 years.
Wow.
Crazy.
Mm.
Crazy.
So whereabouts are you thinking? Along here or around there? Or where do you think?
For fishing? I think for a very, very short session, the best way is right here in the middle.
Yeah. Where that shallow bit is? Are those plastic ducks in there?
Yes, yes. So don't fish in there.
Right.
Don't fish in there, but out of the
when
plastic ducks.
When has anyone said don't fish in amongst the plastic ducks?
That's crazy. Do you see many fish showing, crashing?
No. Oh.
Right, how you feeling?
Well, Jean-Baptiste is full of confidence that we'll be able to catch, but I'm still kind of a little bit apprehensive, really. I mean, this place is absolutely huge. I know I keep going on about it, but Jean-Baptiste has said it's one of the biggest lakes in northern France. I mean, it goes over in that direction for 2 miles, similarly the other way as well, and it also kind of goes out of sight and round there. So even what we're looking at here isn't the lake in its entirety. But yeah, I mean, there's, you know, kind of pessimistic or apprehensive as I am, I'm still mega, mega excited. I haven't fished a lake this big probably for about 10 years when I was over in Lake Reduta in Romania. So, I mean, who knows what a water this size could hold, and it receives very little angling attention. So there could be a big surprise out there. Who knows? Going for what's it
in your look,
in my look,
your swim
I'm thinking look. 80s Cassian styley slash early Orient days. that's the look I'm going for.
Actually, to be fair, yeah, because they didn't have pods back in them days.
No,
they did have
like little mound of rock around the bank sticks. That's the look I'm going for. I had a rod pod in my hand. I thought, shall I? Well, in terms of practicality, yes, I should. And I thought, nah. She's got it all. Pure Instagram gold. Okay, it's about time to get out in the boat, find a few spots and get the rigs in position. So I'm just going to talk you through the rigs I'm going to be using here. As always with me, the theme is kind of simple yet strong. And because this is a active gravel workings, I can only assume there'll be all sorts of snags and objects down there that I can't see. These sort of iron workings that you already see, that there's zebra mussels littering the margins, really sharp bars that come, you can see them just under the surface. So tackle really does have to be beefed up if we're going to avoid any losses. Now, if we come down here, I've got a lead core leader here, 45 pound lead core leader. That's just to reinforce the main line just above the end tackle itself. Coming down from that, we have a lead clip type setup, and here we have an 8 ounce Klingon lead. Going to be fishing at quite long range. We're going to be using the boat, and some of the spots that we are likely to be fishing are going to be well in excess of 200 metres, so we need a nice heavy lead to hold the bottom there. Coming down from this, I have 35 pound Cortex mat hook link. All I've done there is just tied a large loop on the end and then doubled it over. Just sort of helps create like a anti-tangle boom. And coming down here, we have a size 2 LS hook. That's a long shank hook. And over the eye, I'm using one of the micro line aligner adapters that really does sort of help the hook turn and improve the hooking properties massively. Then we have two bits of silicone just on the shank there, just to trap the hair in place and also create a blowback effect. And the hook bait, I've got an 18 mil Odyssey Triple X topped off with one of the Dairy Supreme pop-ups, just to create a nice balanced slow sinking snowman type hook bait. So yeah, that's what I'm putting all my faith in. So let's get in the boat and get them out there. Seven meters there. Okay, well, I've just had a little scan around this shingle gravel bank. That's got to be lucky, hasn't it?
Well, it didn't hit us.
Yeah, I've just had a little scout around the shingle bank, and it's very deep, very close to the bank. So I've just within a few feet. It's, 7 metres? Just a few feet from the bank. I would just come a little bit further along this gravel bank, and we're much farther out, and we've got a nice sort of shallow continuation of sort of just under 3 meters, so around 10 feet deep. So it's a little bit shallower for longer. I'm sure just a couple of rod lengths that way, it drops down to sort of 7 meters. So I'm a bit happier fishing in this depth of water. Yeah, 3 meters still. It's a lot flatter, a lot smoother. If I put any baits along down there, I just feel they're just going to roll down into the abyss. But here it's a lot more of a gradual slope, so I think it's a nicer place to drop the rigs. And that's what I'm going to do now.
fishing, Mark?
It's mega exciting. I am absolutely buzzing. Harry saw a carp. He nearly wet his pants, didn't you?
Yeah.
And because we're fishing at such long range here, decided to use a braided mainline. This is the 40-pound submerged braid. And because there's absolutely no stretch at all, that means bite indication is enhanced massively. Also, should the fish move towards any snags, and there's a shallow bar over there which I want to try and steer it away from, that lack of stretch just means I can move that fish away a lot safer, a lot quicker than if I was using a mono, which has a greater degree of a stretch. Also, I'm using the springer arm indicators. They have a flexible fiberglass arm which is constantly putting that line under tension. So as soon as the fish basically picks up and moves away, I'll know about a take almost immediately. So yeah, that's one rod in place. Let's get the other two done before it gets dark. I'm just about to go and take out my third and final rod. While we've been out in the boat so far, we have seen quite a few fish showing over the other side. So this one is going long. I've got 550 meters of braid on my reel, and I'm probably going to use every inch of that. So yeah, let's set sail and here we go. Okay. Look at them bad boys. At first glance, look like any ordinary rich tea biscuit, but you have to look again, look closely. They're not McVitie's at all. They're actually, why are you laughing? They're not McVitie's at all. The Lidl specials, 23p a pack. It's like five for the price of one. You don't seem impressed. Well, it's just coming up to 11 o'clock. It's an absolutely gorgeous night. It is so deadly quiet. You can't hear a car or any noise at all. It is so quiet, pitch black. I'm sleeping under the stars and I can see just about, seems like every star in the universe. It is such a dark sky. And it really is such a wonderful atmospheric place. And as much as I am enjoying being here already, I'm already kind of hoping that I won't be here for much longer, if I can help it. Because if we do get to sort of 7, 8, 9 o'clock in the morning and we haven't caught, that to me would say that things aren't going to plan and we would then be behind schedule. We've got other countries we need to go to, but I am quietly confident. We have seen quite a lot of fish in the area, especially that rod that I sent out quite a long way. There was fish all around the boat when I was dropping the rig. So I think we are in the right location. So I think all that is left for me to do is get my head down, try and get a bit of a power nap, and hopefully I will be rudely awaken rather soon.
Well, it's just after 1 o'clock in the morning. Just had a take on the rod that I rode over the long rod, and struck into nothing. Definitely take the lead. The lead had been discharged, the silicon pushed right up against the eye of the hook. I don't know, but struck into nothing. I don't know, the hook doesn't feel as sharp as it did when it first went out. I don't know what's happened there really. But I've now got to row it back out there. I'm not rowing it out, am I? Oh God. Long. After I missed that bite, I had to go back out and drop that rig. I'm using the braided mare line, you feel absolutely everything, you feel the line. It's proper sort of heart in the mouth stuff. The heart's proper pounding as well. Boat. It's just suddenly pinged. So I don't know if it's pinged out of the snag. Oh, it's come off and I'm just snagged. I can't tell. I suppose you could just ditch the light for a couple of seconds, could you, just so I can get my bearings. I really can't tell what's happening. Oh, he's free. We are actually playing the fish now. Ooh. Oh, she's here. Oh. Didn't want me retinas. I could see the fish. I can't see where the fish is. Oh, there you go.
Oh, fish. Yes!
We have a carp. Oh. Yes. That was a bit scary for a few minutes. I couldn't tell if I was playing the fish or just winding into a snag. Right, let's try and find bank and head over there and we'll have a look at him back at shore. So here we are, that is the challenge up and running. To think we got to a 1,000 plus acre
French Lake, I managed to get the three rods in place just as it was getting dark to catch a fish from such a huge expanse of water in such a short space of time. I'm absolutely over the moon. I'm over the moon to catch it, but I think it's put us in a great position. It certainly put us on schedule, if not ahead of schedule. So yeah, feeling quite buoyant at the moment. But what I'm going to do now, I'm going to slip this fella back. I'm going to have another extra couple of hours kip, and then we can get packed away at first light and over to our next country. Started on the gravel extraction over on the other bank. It's a cold morning. It's really fresh. I don't think I've ever woken up to a view quite like this one. Absolutely stunning. Really need this one, to be honest, but he's very welcome all the same, especially on such a lovely morning on such an epic venue. Probably one of the best mornings I've woken up to in a long, long time. But as stunning as it is, I'm really, really tired. I'm gonna have to force myself, I think, to go back in the sleeping bag and have an hour's kip at least, because we've got a long drive, haven't we, today?
Yeah.
So, it's one of them mornings where I can't really take my eyes off the water and what's going on around me, but I think I am going to have to. I know as soon as I get in that car and start driving, I'll be sleepy.
What's the time?
Late.
How late?
Half past nine.
Yeah, it's not as late as I thought.
No? We need to get moving though, don't we?
Yeah.
Just another half hour. France behind us now, and we're currently just over 2 hours into a 4.5 hour drive to our next venue.
But first of all, I've got to say a massive, massive thank you to John Baptiste. His info was absolutely spot on. He really did put us right on the fish. I mean, if we'd have turned up last night, late in the day at such a huge venue and had to walk around trying to find fish, I dread to think how much time that would have taken. So thanks for that, JB. But we are now en route to our next country, and what is the home of English carp fishing? Holland.
You can't say that.
I can. That is where Donald Leaney brought his fish and stocked him into Red Meyer Pool and various other venues back in the day. So there we go. So I can't wait to get to our next venue and catch an original Leaney. We are going to a canal, and we've been speaking to another one of our overseas consultants, Mark Norman. He assures us it's there's a decent chance of catching a fish out of there in a relatively short space of time. Other than that, I don't even know whereabouts it is. I'm just following the sat nav religiously. So yeah, I can't wait to get there and have a look at the venue. I'll see you there. Here we are at a small town somewhere in Holland. Before we actually make our way over to the canal, we need to get our tickets and licenses. So now we just need to find the fish and tackle shop, which is somewhere near here. So yeah, follow me. We're here, let's go guys. It's 32 euros and you get a free guinea pig. Brilliant, thank you very much. Okay, bye. Right, now we're all legal, we can go and find the canal. Give it to me like a bass drop. Right, not being funny, but whenever anyone seen a canal like that, like look at it flowing. How is that a canal? I think this could count as river and canal in one go.
It's called, the name of the venue is the Valley Canal.
Yeah, but you know, this challenge was set in England under English rule, and I have never seen a canal that flows like that. So technically, by English standards, that would be called a river. It doesn't look overly inviting, does it? It's like a sort of like a PTT colour to it. It's flowing like the Zambezi River. I don't think it's going to be very easy. Who am I to argue with someone that's got something like 10 black belts in karate? So yeah, fair enough.
What are you basing this swim decision on?
It's not exactly watercraft at its finest, is it? You haven't seen anything. It's just I'm going on the fact that we have the bridge probably 50 metres upstream, and on this fairly straight canal, it's the only sort of bend along, I don't know, what must be pushing on for 3/4 of a mile of canal. So I suppose, yeah, the bridge and this bend are quite a noticeable feature. And then because it's on the bend, we do have this area of slacker water. directly in front of this little spot here. So it certainly looks like the most favourable location on this stretch.
And you can park your van right behind it.
That hadn't even entered my mind.
Grass looks sluggy, doesn't it?
Well, I've already noticed quite a few squashed ones. Yeah, it looks terrifyingly sluggy. Well, I'm trying to think positive here because if I'm honest, I'm not really feeling this at all. And my massive assumption was we've seen about a mile of this canal. And there's very little variation. Well, this canal runs right down the perimeter of the town. So my assumption was there'd be very little variation around the other bits that we haven't seen. So while I'm kind of thinking, well, why would the fish be here? Well, why would they be anywhere else? So, like I say, probably a massive assumption, but I'm trying to think positive. I'm not actually doing my Kermit impression.
Hey everybody, I'm Kermit the Frog. Well,
it's actually a toad.
It is a toad.
So the gag doesn't work. Well, it's almost dark now, and for the past few moments, I've just been casting around the swim with a bare lead, just to try and find a few clear areas amongst the streamer weed. Now, the streamer weed is actually quite patchy. It isn't kind of just in the edge or just on the far margin. It's sort of patchy all over the swim. But I have found two clear areas, decent sized areas, probably bigger than a bivvy in amongst all the weed. So I've already got one rod in place.
I'll do.
dropped in a nice spot, and rather conveniently it's in line with a street light on the far bank. I don't know if it's going to come on or not, but it'll be a nice far bank marker to cast to should I need to redo it in the night. I've just scattered around half a kilo of Odyssey Triple X boilies around it. And the rig itself is pretty much the same as what we were doing yesterday over on the big lake in France. There's one slight change though, in that I am using a SSBP hook in a size 2. Now this has a beaked point rather than the straight point LS that I was using yesterday. My reason for changing the hook is the bait is more likely to be susceptible to the tensions of roach or bream or chub, smaller fish that could be nudging the bait, moving it around, and that could cause a straight point hook to damage on the gravel. Whereas a beaked point is just a little bit more protected really, and a little bit less prone to becoming blunt on the gravel. So there we go, that's been given a dip in one of the liquid boosters there, just because it is flowing water, there's a bit of colour there, and it just kind of helps the fish to single out the hook bait from the free offerings. So let's get that in place. Bonk. You can also notice here that I've actually changed my reels over. I was fishing with the 40 pound submerged braid before because we were fishing at extreme range. We wanted to improve bite indication. Well, we're only fishing close in here. So I've gone over to the 23 pound Exocet mainline. It's as strong as old boots, and sinks well, and it's also virtually invisible in the water, so has everything I want it to do. We have a dog, nine doggin. Nine. Come out the way, out of the way. Nine doggin. Come on. Come on, out of there. Nine. Come under. There we go. Come on.
Come on.
Come
on. Come on.
Come on. didn't even understand about Dutch.
I don't think that was in any way Dutch at all.
Well, Mark's just left and he really has lifted the mood actually. Before he came down, we're all a little bit, doesn't look great. But no, he's been giving us stories about some of his previous sessions on here, where he's had some really good results. And he also said that this stretch has actually done fish to over 20 kilos, so 44, 45 pound, which, yeah, that's really got me very, very excited, actually. But it does seem that the canal has come alive since it got dark. I've seen a couple of fish topping, which they're not carp, but look like chub or bream or something, but we hadn't seen anything up until that point. Just had a take then as well, which, again, it wasn't off a carp, it was off a smaller fish, but it, at least it's some form of life. Crickets are chirping away, all the city behind me is all lit up, street lights are on, there's cyclists and little mopeds zooming around on the other side. It's all looking very cool. And I've gone from not really fancying it one bit to being quite expectant, actually. And I'm gonna sit down, have a brew and kind of soak it all in.
Well, tonight's got off to exactly the same start as last night on the Big French Lake. Just watched the fish roll just a rod length from my left-hand rod. Probably about half an hour later, absolutely goes into meltdown. Pick it up, had the fish on for a few seconds, and then it come off. Once again, the stream of weed foiled me yet again. I'm still shaking, actually. I just don't know. On the plus side, you know, it's only sort of 11 o'clock. So we've got all night ahead of us, really. I'm just hoping I get another chance. Coming back here again today?
Yeah.
You're back here?
Yeah, I'll be on time.
Okay. Find it in my canal. It would have been far too easy if I'd have had that fish at 11 o'clock though, wouldn't it? Rocking up, catching one within 3 hours, where's the fun in that? It wouldn't have been fair, would it, really? Alright, let's get packed away then.
Got no chance.
Well, today has been an absolute write-off, really. That weed cutting started quite early this morning, about 8:30 this morning. And there's been rafts and rafts of floating weed coming down all day. I've checked out quite a few areas downstream, which obviously are affected just the same as this. I've drove quite a few miles upriver as well. And I did go and visit a few weir pools up there, but they were just flowing so fast. I really wasn't feeling them at all, to be honest. So I've made a tactical decision to leave this venue and head over to another country. But what I've done just a few moments ago, I've baited these areas with a few kilo boilies on the spots that I fished last night. Plan is head over to the other country, hopefully catch one fairly quickly, then we can get back here, fish over those pre-baited areas, which hopefully will be rocking by then, and pull it out of the bag last minute. Victory is mine, everyone's a winner. This is what happens when you choose to listen to Harry instead of the sat nav. Bravo, Charrington, bravo. That's like 25 minutes on top of our journey.
See
now.
See what these guys are doing? They're just doing a Yui here. Don't wanna close
my eyes. Yeah, Schnell. I don't wanna fall asleep, cause I miss you, babe. Quick sat nav, don't do it again. And I don't wanna miss you, babe. Just even when I dream of you. The sweetest dream will never do. I still miss you, babe. And I don't wanna miss you, babe. Well, we are nearly at our next destination. We've been driving for about 3.5 hours and we've got another 30 minutes to go as well, so it's taken a lot longer than expected. But we are in what is possibly, though definitely, the carpiest country on the planet, Belgium, home to some stunning chestnut mirrors, classic looking commons. Ever since I was a kid, I've looked at pictures in the magazines of fish caught from here, and I've always wanted to go, always wanted to catch a Belgian carp, and I haven't until now, but hopefully all that is going to change today. Harry was actually at this venue just a couple of weeks ago, so he knows it quite well. And also speaking to a friend of mine, Jimmy Armstrong, he was here just last week, and he caught a few fish too. We actually meet in one of our European consultants over here, Chris de Klerk. He's going to give us some bang up to the minute local info and intel. So I'm feeling quite confident, very, very excited, very tired, but I really can't wait to get there and get angling. Oh, I like it.
Yeah?
Yeah. Oh, that's proper, isn't it? See, that is a canal. That thing we're at before doesn't look anything like that, does it?
No.
That's a canal. If any cyclists, I'm going to flatten. Where do we go? Oh, he's parked in a good spot. Hey, dude, you all right? What's up, man? Good to see you again.
Hi, Mark.
Good to see you. Good to see you.
All right, Chris.
Harry.
Damn, you're looking. Oh, if you're wearing yours,
looking,
I'll wear mine.
Looking what?
You're looking mighty fine, is what I was going to say. Yeah, but I better put mine on now.
Right, what do you think?
I think this is a proper canal. This is a canal. Just got here, met up with Chris, shoved a bottle of beer in my hand. That's Belgian hospitality for you. We've got a bit of a. Is it a warm water inflow pipe or something, Chris? Is it warm water source, this one?
Slightly warmer.
And that's coming from what looks like a crystal meth lab factory behind me. I've seen Breaking Bad, I know what that is. They say it's phosphorus or something. But no, it's looking good. I can't wait to get the van unloaded and get fishing. I really can't. Well, I'm just spooling up with a couple of rod lengths of 45 pounds armadillo snag leader. Chris tells me there's quite a lot of concrete blocks and iron rods in the edge, which are all sort of covered in zebra mussels. So to prevent the main line just from getting cut through like a hot knife through butter, this snag leader really is really tough and abrasion resistant, and it'll just protect that last few yards against any breakages. Well, this is the spot. You can see the sort of see the reason for the snag leaders by looking at the concrete blocks just on the edge of the wall here, with all the iron poking out. All I'm going to do here is just lower it in front of this inflow, just have a little feel around, check what the bottom's like, just lowering the lead down. Somewhere it feels flat. I felt that sort of clatter off a couple of rocks and then sort of gradually come to a stop. It's right there. All I'm doing, just putting in a few little half baits, just kind of scattered just down there. It's a sort of area that's going to hold fish, so if they're there, there's no need to sort of put load of bait right on top of them. If they're there, they're there. Start, is it? Not really the start I was hoping for. I can't really. I've swallowed a fly. I can't really think of anything positive to say about that. Right. You ever frisbeed a bream before, Chris? Let me show you. Or feed the same bream. There you go. I was only joking about the frisbee.
This is 5 o'clock in the morning. Bit of a a restless night yet again for me. Had 3 or 4 bream for the night. The noise of them lorries thundering past kept waking me up for every 10-15 minutes.
kind of real big and had come past. And I'm in that factory. Behind me kicking at light, that's there, that made me jump. But we're playing a carp. I made a bit of a rig change during the night, an attempt to avoid the bream really. I went over to my get out of jail, ever faithful, take it everywhere, in stiff rig. And well, this was the first bite on it. I didn't get after I swapped over from the balanced bottom bait, I haven't had any more bream. This is my first bite on it. That is a relief. Believe me, that is a relief.
Well, it may not be the Belgian beast I was hoping for, but it's still my very first Belgian carp. And it keeps this challenge very much alive. But I'm not going to waste too much time here. I'm going to slip him back. I'm going to get packed down. I'm going to get all the kit packed away into the van. And we're going to bomb back over to Holland because there is chance yet that we can pass this challenge just in the nick of time. Okay, I'm just having a quick brew before I get packed down and on the road, and I just thought I'd go through the rig I've been using in a little bit more detail. I mentioned that it's a hinge stiff rig, but I fish mine a little bit differently. When we look at the chod section here, it's tied with 25 pound rigidity, but it's doubled over. And it's tied very much in the same way as a multi-rig. This one strand is doubled over, obviously to create two, and then pass through the eye coming in over. And on the loop end, I pass on one of the micro hook ring swivels before then passing it over the point of the hook. And when you pull it tight, it creates your small D section. And then the doubled over the strands there are tied in exactly the same way as I would a single strand with a two-turn blood knot. And then the boom, I have a inch and a half, 2-inch loop, just allows a little bit more movement for the chod section to slide along. And that boom section is tied from 35 pound matte green Cortex. And there we have a 4-ounce lead on a leg clip, sat below around 2 feet of 45 pound lead core. And the beauty of the hinge stiff rig, for some reason, it does have a knack of kind of avoiding the bream. I don't know why, whether they just have difficulty dealing with it or getting it in the mouth, I'm not sure. But also, it allowed me to use a smaller hook bait than what I have already been using. I've been using 18 mil bottom bait topped off with like a 13, 14 mil pop-up and caught a bream on that. Switched over to a hinge stiff with a 14 mil pop-up, and the first bite I got on it was from a carp. So yeah, it certainly did the trick. The crabs also liked this one a little bit. There's a few little bite marks out of there. But again, that was another reason for changing. I had a rod near this sort of inflow pipe down here, and it was only in the water half an hour. We already got indications where the crabs were mauling at it. Pulled the rig in, pulled the bait in, and it was mauled to pieces. As that's been out for quite a while, and that's the first crab attack I've had. So yeah, it worked a treat. Now come and get packed up, Harry.
Yes.
Thank you.
So you've got one more fish to catch, one more venue.
Yeah.
What's your plan?
Well, we are in Holland now, and we are going back to the river where we were yesterday. The plan is to fish over them pre-baited spots. Hopefully all the weed cutting has now stopped. And yeah, we can fish over them baited spots, and hopefully there should be fish feeding
Mark.
There.
Mark, there's... You can't go back there.
What's wrong with that? What?
You can't go back there.
I can't go back there.
You've already caught from a canal.
Yeah. I know what you're going to say.
It's called the Valley Canal.
Hang on. What was the very first thing you said when we got there? What was the first thing you said?
It looked...
No. You didn't. You went, this isn't a canal. It's a river. You said exactly that.
Whether or not...
That's exactly what you said.
Hold on. Whether or not I said that, Mark... The fact remains, it's called the Valley Canal.
Hang on, you set the challenge, it's a canal. And you told me when we got there, this isn't a canal, it's a river.
But I never said that you could count it as a river.
What?
You can't go there.
Well, I am going there. That's like, we're nearly there now. We've just been... Hang on. We've been driving for 2.5 hours. 2.5 hours we've been driving.
Well, you needed to get into Holland.
Why did you say this now?
You needed to get to Holland.
Yeah, well...
You could have gone to Germany, but you would have been driving for even longer.
It's a river.
It's not a river.
Hang on. We even sat down and Googled it. And you saw what it said. We Googled it, and it described it as a river running around a city. Didn't it? That's how it described it.
Yes,
well, thank you.
But the fact remains, it's called the Valley Canal.
It's a river. It isn't. We looked at it, we went online and looked at it, and it said, it's a river running round a city. Websites, the internet is never wrong.
Arrived back at the river, canal river,
canal.
And it's in exactly the same state as it was yesterday. They're still cutting the weed. We're no further forward really. There's rafts and rafts of weed and bulrushes coming down. You can see what's coming down here now. It's like a floating island coming down the river. But conditions are different. It's bright, it's sunny. We've got a few options. We can either go upstream to the first weir pole. I don't think they're cutting above that weir pole, so if we go there, then we should be fine. We shouldn't be troubled by the floating weed at all. The other option is we go downstream into the city. There's a few sort of canalized areas, like sort of like offshoots off the main river, where, you know, there won't be any floating weed and the fish maybe are there escaping the main flow. It's a lovely sunny day, it's warm, bright conditions, it's ideal for spotting carp, so I think we'll go for a long walk, a bit of a hike, and see what we can see. Says that is not a canal, and just to prove it, there's a dude over there fly fishing for trout. That doesn't happen on canals.
Well, it's been another very frustrating day. We spent most of the day. Oh, what is this? I don't think it is a carp. I think it's a rubber dub. But I better play it carefully in case it is a small carp. I think it's a chub, which could easily be disguised as a small common carp. Is it a chub? What is it?
Is it an eye?
I don't know. Oh yeah, it's an eye, yeah. No, it's a small common carp without any barbels.
I've caught one then before. There we go, we've got an eye. So, yeah, there you go. Another species off the list, I suppose. First fish from Holland, and it's an eyed. Well, sort of happy with that, really.
Before I was interrupted by the eyed, I was going to say that today's been very frustrating. The floating rafts of weed have made things almost impossible. We ended up moving several miles upstream to a very nice looking weir pole, but that proved out to be very snaggy, it was very fast flowing, and it amounted to nothing really. Well, now we are in our original plot, and for all the miles that we've walked and investigated, and we have covered a lot of miles, this is the only place where we've actually seen a carp. Remember, we saw that fish show 20 minutes later, half an hour later, I had a take, which I unfortunately lost. So with all that in mind, this does seem like the best location to be in. Now, Harry has been banging on at me all day. Why are you going back there? Why are you there? We've already caught a carp for a canal. You don't need to be there. Well, in my mind, this is not a canal. It's a river. It's more of a river than the River Neen when we did the first river challenge. And as it happens, things are panning out in exactly the same fashion. I hooked a fish, it went in the stream of weed, had a hook pull, and that was that. And it's all very reminiscent of that, and I do feel like I've got two scores to settle, really. So I'm the one that's driving the van. I've made the calls on this occasion, Harry, and we are back here. I'm actually feeling quite confident for tonight. We had the weed cutter boat in this section yesterday, so it's had 24 hours to settle, and the swim already feels a little bit more alive than it did that first night we fished on here. Obviously we had that eyed, and we've had quite a few sort of knocks on the rod tip as well. It just feels a little bit more, I don't know, it just feels a little bit more right. And I've also brought out the reinforcements. I've got enough tea to last me tonight. I'm sleeping under the stars. I am feeling positive and in a good mood. Only thing is, we do have to be off very early in the morning. We have to leave here at 7 o'clock at the very latest to catch our crossing back home. So the next time you see me, I'll either have a carp in my hands or my head in my hands.
Right at the dying moments, just a few 5 minutes literally before we have to be on the road, and I've got a bream. Oh, no. That's a nice farewell, isn't it? that kind of sums up last night, really. But we have to be on the road now, so I suppose that's a fail. Absolutely gutted. It looks so good here, especially when we very first came here. We had that take a little more than 3 hours after casting out. And if I'd have landed that fish, this challenge would have been done and dusted with 24 hours to spare. So it just shows how fine their margins are, I suppose, between success and failure. I always like to end on a positive note. The very attractive Dutch girl just gone past on his bicycle. There we go. That's all I can say. That's all I can say. So, till next time, I'll see you then.
It's a cold day and it's lit my fire. How cool is that? I think it's best we get back on with the job in hand. An incredibly unlucky result there for Mark, a result that probably still smarts just a little even today. We're moving into October now and we're off with Team England gold medalist Mark Bartlett, and he's fishing at Linear Fisheries. Mark is undoubtedly one of the greatest haulers of carp in this country, but how's he going to react when the fishing isn't going exactly the way he wants it to?
I'm a couple of hours into my session. I'm down at Linear Fisheries on Hardwick, and I just fancied coming on here this time of year. Not many people seem to fish this lake as much as they should. There's some brilliant features out here as well, and been fishing for about 3 hours now. Got set up, put a little bit of bait out. I'm into my first carp already. So things are looking pretty promising, really. Feels like a decent fish. Good fish, that. Huh? Right home. Oh, quite pleased with that one. Looks a pretty decent fish, to be fair. Oh, I thought we were going to start with a few smaller ones, but we've gone straight in there with a bit of a tank. Well, a touch over 27 pound. That's a brilliant start to the session. I've been fishing about 3 hours. And to catch a fish like this, I would have been happy if this had been the end result of a few fish, but to start with this is pretty cool. So just goes to prove as well that the way I'm fishing for them is mega instant for autumn and even through the winter. It is really effective the way I'm going to be fishing, and I caught this using maggots, but it's getting dark now, so I'm going to get this one back, get my rod sorted, get a bit more bait out there as well, and then tomorrow hopefully we'll get a few more of these and we'll go through exactly how to do some proper maggot fishing. Just down there you can see a swan. Just getting this bait out for the night after I caught that fish, and straight away started spotting, especially maggots, because they sink quite slow. The swans, they're straight on it. So tip number one is get him down in the edge. You've only got to throw a couple of bits of food in every now and again for him, But for all the while he's sat there, he's not absolutely pillaging your bait when he's coming out the old spod. It's something I've done for quite a few years now as well, because they can absolutely smash a spod load of bait in within, well, within seconds before it could even fall down through the water the length of their neck. So, yeah, just a couple of bits of bait every now and again, and he'll stay there and not bother you where you're putting your bait in. After I caught that 27 pounder just before dark yesterday, I mean, I thought I would have caught another one, to be fair, but I haven't. Went through the night biteless. Heard a show or two out in the main area of the lake where I'm fishing, but I have just seen a fish show down the edge. So I've just wound in one of the rods off the bait and chucked a solid bag where I've seen the fish show. But I am keeping the faith in the maggots. I know they're gonna do me good. They always do. So, but talking of maggots, I just want to show you, you know, how I sort of keep my maggots fresh. Like, I see a lot of people struggle, especially through the warmer months, how they look after their maggots. And to me, I think from a match fishing background, it's important to look after the bait that I'm going to be using. And the best thing I can suggest to keep your maggots, rather than have a bucket with a load of holes stabbed in the top where the air gets in and then they keep them moving around and they can sweat out then. They produce a lot of ammonia when they're moving around. I keep them in an airtight bucket, so this is sealed and they go torpid. And they look a little bit stretched, but when you take, you know, when you put them in the bucket, they actually start coming back to life and they go back to how they were originally. So just keep them in a nice airtight bucket. And you can see there that, you know, they're not moving at all. And then the next thing is when you know, especially carp anglers, when you buy them in bulk from tackle shops, they come in the sawdust. A lot of the tackle shops, they won't actually prepare the maggots for you as they would for the match anglers. So just get yourself a little riddle, and then whatever amount of maggots you're going to use, you can just riddle all the sawdust off. You know, they're nice and clean now. And whereas a match angler would use maize flour, that, you know, the little yellow powder to make them all nice and fluffy, I actually just use some krill meal. I've seen a lot of match anglers do really well on this. And what they do is they just cover their maggots in this krill meal. And to be fair, I've been using it for a couple of years now, and it adds like a really nice aroma to the maggots. It certainly doesn't do them any harm at all. It's just enhancing them further again. So that's the maggots all prepared. I'm gonna fire a few more spods out into the lake just on the spot, just to create a bit of interest. The water's quite deep and the fish can be sometimes up in the water moving around. So I'm going to pop a few of these out, and hopefully that'll get a response or two from the fish. Well, I was sat there waiting for something to happen, and it wasn't. And I've just heard a fish behind me. We're on a spit here on Hardwick, and there's like actually like another lake behind us. I've heard one show, so I've wound in, I've gone for a walk around, I've climbed a tree, and I've actually seen the water's, like in this side, the water's crystal clear, and in that side, the water's slightly coloured. I've seen a couple of fish cruising around as well, so I think, you know, it doesn't matter what tactic you use, like, you will not catch what isn't there. That's like the basics of carp fishing. So, you know, as good as the maggots are, if they're not there, I'm not going to catch them. So I'm going to take the gamble. I'm going to pack up, and I'm going to go and spend the night up there, where hopefully I can show you what the maggots really do. So, yeah, let's go and have a go.
I've been in this swim about 5 minutes now. I've literally unloaded, well, just got my rods off the barrow. I've chucked a couple of little zigs on and just chucked them out into this bay. Like when I went up the tree, there was a couple of fish cruising around. They were deep, but they were cruising around, actively swimming around. And where there was one, there was, you know, like another one behind it following. So, yeah, I've just pinged out two little zigs just out there. But what I'm going to do now is, you know, I want to fish on the bottom, get something going really. So I'm going to have a quick look more out in the open water just for a little spot. I'm just looking for a nice clean area just to present this bait. So yeah, I'm going to have a couple of chucks and see what we can find. Well, I've had a couple of chucks with this lead. I just got a bare lead on a braided line. And I've used this to feel around. I felt around for a hard donk. And once I found that, what I've done is I've searched that area, clipped it up on the spool, used the tree in the background, and just searched around that area. And what I found is that where this hard patch is that, I mean, from what I can gather, it is pretty much polished gravel. It is absolutely solid. There's no weed or nothing. Whereas around it, if you cast like a couple of meters to the left and right, it is sort of, feels like Canadian weed, probably 4-6 inches high. And yeah, so that, like to me, that's pretty obvious where I want to be fishing. And another thing, I can present my bait on that spot like an absolute dinner plate, and they can come in. And also to the right, it's slightly deeper as well. So I, you know, what I can gather is a bit of a hump. And with the fish being up in the water from seeing them in the tree, I think this is, you know, this is gonna be a prime spot to try and nick a bite or two. So I'm gonna get a bit of bait in on that spot, not too much, and see if we can get a couple of bites. Well, once I found that spot out in the lake, I clipped it up on the spool. I've put my marker sticks out. I've wrapped it round. Unfortunately, it's 11 wraps exactly. So I've clipped up a couple of rods to 11 wraps, put a little elastic marker on there. I'm just doing my spod rod now, and it's over 10 foot deep out in the lake. And my personal preference is I clip up my spod 1 foot shorter for every 3 foot of water. So I've clipped my spod rod up, you know, nearly 3 foot shorter than 11 wraps. And this will allow for the swing back on the leads, and my bait is going to be falling bang over the top of my rigs. So yeah, let's fire a bit of bait out now. Well, you see me putting that bait out on the spot that we found. Just before I was gonna chuck my rods out, I just had a scout at the margin, and I actually climbed a tree that I hadn't climbed previously. And at the base of the tree, there's a nice little clear spot, and there were a few carp sort of milling about. So I got some maggots, put them on the spot, went back 10 minutes later, and there's a couple of fish feeding. So I've just got a little rig now, basically a solid bag rig, little inline drop off, little bit of pink plastic corn, just because the water's actually quite colored now. Hopefully they'll be able to pick that out, and just a little bag of pellets. So I'm gonna go and creep through the bush, drop this on the spot, and fingers crossed, go and catch myself a carp. So let's go and have a go. Jungle warfare going on, but what an opportunity. Seen a couple of fish, what was that, 3 or 4 minutes? And yeah, feels all right actually, to be fair. I'm just gonna wade down to a nice safe place to lander. Ha ha ha. Well, we were sat over there, and I'd just come round. Had a look in this margin. There was some fish on the spot, put a few maggots on there, and it just goes to show how instant these maggots are, especially this time of year. And that rod was in the water for 3 or 4 minutes maximum. Threw a few maggots in just to get them to go off the spot, but obviously they're interested in the maggots, so you've got to be quick. Got the rig in there pretty quick. Just sat there, waited a couple of minutes, and she nearly pulled my arm off. She's in the bag. Just goes to show, we sat over there for a night, nothing was really happening. I think as carp anglers, we're all guilty to formulating a plan before we go somewhere. And you get it in your head what you want to do and how you want to be fishing, but just goes to show that at all times, be prepared to change, and fish how the fish want to be fished for, They're telling you what they want, they're in the edge, they're feeding on little spots, and we've fished accordingly and we've caught one straight away. So there's always something to be learned with carp fishing. I think that's the beauty of it. Made up with that. I don't stalk many fish, so to stalk this one out the edges, it's quite nice for me. Probably about 18 pounds. I'm not going to weigh her, but what a lovely carp and a lovely way to catch her. Pretty uneventful night. I was proper confident that we were going to catch off the bait last night, but it hasn't happened for whatever reason. That's carp fishing. The fish have been mega active. They've boshed all night. I've been up, walking about, I've been watching them and watching them and watching them and catching none of them. It's been emotional. I've seen a good fish show just behind my bait, probably 10 yards behind my bait, so I'm going to leave those rods be. I've baited some spots in the margin in case we get an opportunity like yesterday to stalk one. And I've chucked some zigs at these fish, I've chucked some single up baits, I've chucked some bags, I've gone for the old textbook of carp fishing and got zero for it. Going to see what's going to happen today. But yeah, it's been pretty frustrating, to be fair. So, doing my head in. Well, yeah, we'll keep plodding away, keep seeing if we can get a chance. Just gonna have a quick look at the rigs that I've caught the fish on. They're super simple rigs, but they are actually really effective. The 27 pounder that we caught, I actually caught that one on a 360 rig. Some people think this is quite a controversial rig. I don't. I know a lot of good anglers that catch a lot of big fish on these rigs, and we use them in a super safe way. It's just a little length of 25 pound rigidity, a size 11 ring swivel. That's a size 6 LSC, a couple of hook beads on there, and then I use a blob method to attach the hook bait with a little rig ring swivel. One thing I do is I put a bit of shrink tube just over the eye of the hook. Any controversy about this rig is due to the eye of the hook catching in the net. It's nothing to do with when you're playing a fish, it's just when the rig itself is actually in the landing net. So just a tip for if you are going to use this rig, when you net the fish, make sure when you scoop the fish up in the net, you lift the net up nice and high, the fish will go right to the bottom of the net. And just be careful when you remove the fish from the water. That is when the damage is done. Nothing to do with the rig when you're actually either hooking the fish or playing the fish. So just be careful. If you're worried, put it in a sling. Make sure you roll the net down nice and just check the hook hold or even unhook it in the water and you'll be absolutely fine. I've used this rig for years and not caused a problem at all. And it is a super effective big fish rig, this. I've caught hundreds of big fish on this. The next rig, this is the one that I caught the 18 pounder on at the edge. And this has probably caught me the most fish throughout my whole fishing career. This is just a simple solid bag rig. It's 4 inches of 25 pound reflex braid, a little blob of putty on the hook link there. Bit of silicone over the eye of the hook. That's a size 6 SSBP, little rig rings on the shank of the hook, and just a single grain of plastic sweetcorn. This is a 3 ounce lead just because we're fishing a short distance out here. Or I use this weight up to sort of 4, even 4.5 ounces sometimes. But it is mega effective. This goes into a PVA bag using the Rapide system. And yeah, this has caught me more fish than any other rig that I've ever used. And it's brilliant for, especially for how we're fishing here, where we're fishing on very hard spots. You cannot present a bait better than what you can do it in this bag here. It is, you know, the fish come in, especially when we're fishing maggots on a hard area, they come in and they hoover these maggots up. They sit very low to the bottom. And as soon as, this is sat in a little pile of pellets, and as soon as they suck this in, it's game over and you got yourself a carp. I seen how effective it was yesterday with my own eyes watching it in the edge. I lowered it in and as soon as the fish went over the top of the rig, that was it, bang, first time I've caught it. So those are the two rigs that I'm using for probably 90% of my angling at the moment. They're mega effective and super efficient. Well, this bay kind of looks devoid of fish now. Been sitting here, you know, hoping nothing's happened. I've walked up around the corner there where I can see across the lake, and I've stood there for about 2 minutes and a fish has plumped his head out, bang over the spot that I was fishing the first night, which is typical. I've still got my line markers on my rod, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to camp down, I'm going to take the rods around there, just finish off the last few hours fishing back where I started, see if I can catch that little devil that thought he was getting away with a free munch. But yeah, so that's the plan now, and hopefully nick a bite before we head off. Well, no more bites. It's been a bit of a struggle, to be honest. But, I mean, I was made up at the start. I had that 27 pounder, which is, that's a fish of a session anyway. You know, I've caught that. I've actually stalked a fish as well. I haven't done that up at Linear Fisheries for quite some time. So that was a pretty special moment. But across the whole lake, over the last, I think 5 or 6 days, it actually hasn't done a bite to another angler, which just goes to show that the maggots have definitely been an edge, because although it seemed like we caught the fish sort of relatively easy at the time, it just goes to show, you know, what the right bait at the right time of year does. So I'm made up with what I've caught for how the lake's actually fishing at the minute. Yeah, I'll be back to catch them again another day, no doubt.
What an absolutely stunning Raisberry One carp. Really, really dark and fought really, really well. Now, being able to adapt and overcome certainly helped Mark out of what could potentially have been a very sticky situation. And wasn't it marvellous that that carp was caught only feet from the bank? We're moving into January now. And Lewis Porter, Steve Spurgeon, Mark Pitchers and Garry Patterson booked themselves a holiday to Gran Canaria for a little bit of carping in the sun. And the cameras went along too, to capture what looked like a really fun trip.
Prop on it. That is
the exact. For, isn't it?
That's what I came here for. Yeah, those are the pictures I've been looking at before I came out here. A proper scaly Canarian carp.
It was back in December 2014 when. Harry, Lewis, Spurge, Gary P and I were all having a bit of a trip over to the Ebro.
We're already, you know, as a group of lads and a group of mates, we'd already said, right, we want to do this again. Where are we going to go? What are we going to do?
I think it was Lewis, I think, that came up with the idea of coming out to Lake Chira. I think it had been on his bucket list. It'd always been on my bucket list ever since I was a kid.
Been out here before. Which was about 6 years ago now, so probably 2010, something like that. Had a brilliant time, caught some lovely fish. Someone mentioned it straight away. I was up for it. I thought, yeah, I'd like a bit of that again. One of the reasons as well for me, having fished both, the Ebro's again, fantastic place, but it is cold this time of year. Whereas coming out to here, it's lovely. It's more like being on your summer holiday, so it really does feel like you are on holiday.
We flew out from Gatwick.
So we met there, it was early in the morning. Our flights were, I think, about 7:30.
Get in. Where's the easy jet? Are we all in? We're missing someone. Where's Spurge?
Is that it?
It was about a 4.5-hour flight. And then from there,
obviously we got a mini bus from the airport that brought us up into the mountains, and then we met with Nick at a bar, loaded our kit into his van, and it was about a 20-minute drive from there. So it was really nice actually, because it's you meet up this lovely bar and an ice cold beer, which was great because straight away you feel like you're on holiday. So I think we all enjoyed that. Ended up having more than one actually, staying a little bit longer than we first thought. But yeah, the ride or the drive up here is a little bit hairy.
It's a steep, twisty, bendy roller coaster of a road. So if you are travel sick, best bring some travel sickness tablets. I didn't, I paid the price.
Yeah, when we originally spoke about coming out on the trip, we'd been out to Ubro twice in December. Again, I suppose we were looking for that time of year, try and get away from it being obviously horrible time of year back in the UK. Generally the fishing's normally poor by then. For whatever reason, it panned out, we came out in January, so middle of Jan. And it turns out, pretty much as we've landed here, it started snowing back in the UK. So we've had a real mild winter, as you'll all know, and then it seems the snaps happened and we've landed out here, so it's absolutely perfect timing for us. We arrived at the villa. We'd obviously already met Nick because he'd met us at the bar. Kelly's wife was there, so obviously we got to meet Kelly. They showed us around, treated us to another nice ice cold beer, which is nice. Showed us our rooms, obviously talked us through the facilities they've got there. But to be quite honest, I think we were all quite itching to get what we needed out of our cases and luggage, gather it together as quick as we possibly could and get down here and start getting some rods out.
The swims were chosen by the toss of a coin.
As I said, there's four of us fishing, so it's easier always to pair up two and two and decide how you want to work it, really. Lewis kind of latched on to me because he's like that and he can't row. So he was quick to think, yeah, he tries to make excuses that it's for other reasons, but I think it's generally because he can't row. Not that you need to row, really. You can catch them from the bank here, but we've decided to use the boats and drop from the boats. I was quite keen to actually fish on the left-hand side of the swim, and I had to go off and get the other boats, join them up and row them back to the area. And when I got back, I found that the swim choice had already been made for me. And we'd won the toss, which is great, but Lewis had actually picked the other side, which at first reckoning, I wasn't impressed.
And he actually picked the side that I didn't initially favour. And then he tried to backtrack and worm his way out of his decision.
It's not fair on Steve. It's not fair on Steve. I'm not a captain.
You've made all the decisions so far.
It's not fair on Steve. I'm not a girl, sir. We need an English coin.
You've chose who has to fish with who.
No.
You've made all the decisions, and you just carry on.
For our first night on the venue, we didn't really have a lot of time to sort of map out the swims or anything. We were kind of setting up in the dark. I got two rods in place. I think everyone else managed to get fishing with three rods. But I think the plan for the first night really was just to try and get off the mark and get a fish under our belts.
It was probably about 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. It was just seemingly starting to get light. One of Lewis's rods was away, and as I said, it was his turn to take the first bite. And it turned out to be a really good fish. So, and to be honest, he had actually dropped that rod on his own. It was the only one he dropped, so fair play to him. So anyway, then shortly after that, I was away and it turned out to be just a small common. So we let that go. Yeah, you're kind of hoping you see a really good fish to start and you think, yeah, you know, that'll be one of them next, but unfortunately it wasn't. But yeah, so the first night, like I say, was actually quiet and it started off in the morning.
Well, this is exactly what we came to Lake Shearer for in Gran Canaria. 31 pounds of scaly, long as you like, mirror carp. Caught just into first light after our first night at the lake. It's the biggest one so far. We've had a few fish between us, but this is definitely the biggest and the prettiest one so far, but we've still got plenty of time to get some more of these. Absolutely blown away. The incredible scenery, incredible hospitality from Carper's Paradise. And as you can see, we are in paradise.
Austin!
Thumbs up!
Proper little beauty.
The difference between an alligator and a crocodile. One says see you later, the other one says in a while.
Middle of the afternoon now on the first full day, and I might look a little bit strange because I've just woken up. It's been a real hectic morning getting rods in and out, being out in the boat and doing most of the rowing as usual. I was having a little siesta and one of the rods has gone. Now what we've been doing, me and Lewis have been sharing bites and it's my turn, so hopefully it's a good one. Feels certainly better than one or two of the smaller ones we've had, so we'll soon find out. Well, there you go. A typical example of a shearer carp. Absolutely beautiful fish. Stunning. Biggest one for me so far. It's a mid-double, it's 15 pound. There's much bigger ones out there, as Lou's already had. So slip her back and hopefully, heat's dropping away a little bit now. Had this bite, it's been a bit quiet for a while. So hopefully them big ones are gonna go on the munch like they seemingly did last night. So getting back.
Going into the second night, I did make a slight change to my tactics. After Lewis and Spurge had so much action fishing in the shallow water, I did position my rods closer to the bank in around sort of 9-10 feet as opposed to the 20 feet I had been fishing on the first night.
Coming into the second night, we'd obviously now, you know, we were happy with what we were doing. We'd already worked out that, you know, going to the shallow water, we were fishing tighter to the far margin. And again, it was quite easy because you can go out in the boat and you can just let around, you know, and find these spots. And we were looking for the softer spots away from any rocks. So if you suddenly donked down and it was 8 foot and then you moved it a foot and it went down to 12, or you're just in a rocky area. So we're just trying to find these leveler, softer spots, which worked out really well. And like I say, we were catching and we were doing well. So we decided to sort of stay in those spots for the night, which was a mistake. We should have moved off in the deeper water, which we eventually did for the last night. We done that. Again, we didn't have loads of bites, but it definitely produced more bites, and it produced more bites first thing. So it just goes to show you, you know, during the day fishing that shallow water, but you definitely seem to need to come off during the night into that deeper water to get the bites.
The following morning, I did actually lose a fish. That was the first bit of action I'd had, and we were sort of 48 hours into the session by then. To say I was gutted is an understatement, really. It was a bit frustrating, to be honest, watching Lewis and Spurge absolutely smashing them up. Where I was fishing at sort of 300 yards range towards like a bay, it just seemed as though the fish were just completely bypassing that bay, working their way down to the margin where Lewis and Spurge were fishing.
It was quiet last night. Lewis had a little common. Mark's actually lost a good fish this morning. This is the first bite of the day on this area. And sun's just hitting that side. We've been fishing in shallow water last night. We're going to move him out a little bit deeper tonight because it has been quiet. But as soon as that sun gets up, it's that far side, bites seem to start coming. It actually feels a little bit better as well, so hopefully it's a half decent fish. Size of it. Well, I have been completely mugged off. It's a small common, but it still don't want to give up now. Look at it. Well, there you go. Yeah, I thought that was the one, gal. Look at it. Get that net and drink, gal. It's probably about mid-double.
Well done, Steve.
Right, cheers, mate. It's another one in the bag. There it is, little mid-double common. Absolutely gave me the run around this one. If I'd lost it, I would have thought I'd lost a really good fish. Looks like it's just been made, beautiful little fish. But it seems to be productive on that far margin, but we are picking up a smaller stamp of fish on, you know, fishing in the shallower water. It seems the lads the week before had the same sort of situation. And fishing the deeper water, I think from later, actually caught some better fish. So I think it's going to be a change of tack for us guys. Certainly as the sun drops away, start getting into that deeper water earlier maybe, trying to pick up one or two of these bigger fish. The one Lewis had come from slightly deeper water, and it's, you know, I think that's probably proof in itself. So there you go, we'll get this one back, hopefully get one of the bigger gills. Myself and Lewis paired up and decided to work as a team. So we're fishing for bites between us, so we're setting all the rods together. Obviously it makes it a lot easier if I come out and do the rowing. It means that Lewis, as we come out to this far side, can donk around with a lead. We haven't got a fish finder or an echo sounder, so it's very easy then. You can find that you're not in too rockier area, etc. Find a nice little leveler area in the shallower water, and it's really easy then to bait it by hand once you're happy with your donk. You can bait up and away you go, you're fishing.
It's really easy to mark what depth we're fishing in as well, even without the fish finder and echo sounder. As long as we're under 12 foot or up to 12 foot, can set the lead on the rod to exactly 12 foot line off the rod tip, and I can just swing it about. As I'm bouncing the lead off the bottom, I can see how much line is still out of the water to the rod tip. It gives us a nice idea of the depth of water, and as I move it along, I can watch to see whether any more line comes out of the water or goes into the water. And if it stays the same, I know I've got a nice flat area. And as you look at the banks on this lake, you can see it's really steep in a lot of areas. We don't want to be fishing on a really steep slope because all of our free bait will roll, and also there's a chance that our lead could roll or the rig could end up rolling. So we're looking for them little flat areas where it stays the same, and they're the areas that we want. I'm also feeling for any rocks because I don't want to really be dropping the lead in amongst some rocks, and I can feel whether or not there's rocks there. What we're looking for is the muddy bits, and I can feel it's a lot softer here. And when I pull the lead in, there's bits of mud on the lead, and we know they're the spots that we want. So this is a really nice area. It's a consistent depth. It feels a lot softer compared to the rocky area just around here. And then all I'm going to do is just lift it up just to make sure that the rig's not got anything on it or it's tangled. Just a little bit of weed there, a little bit of chod. Can't get them out. Just swing it out, let it back down. Oh. There it goes. And then because my line's directly out of the water, it's a really easy marker for Steve just to put a couple of handfuls of maize over it.
Right, fish on. We just got back from putting out the rod that we talked you through about the process that we go through. And sat down. Nick from Carper's Paradise brought us down our breakfast, as is the daily routine down here. Nice bit of sausage and bacon in a baguette. And literally just taking the last mouthful of the baguette, and the rod that we dropped was away. And don't want to be like Steve and say it feels better, but it's pulling. So we'll see. Still about 50, 60 yards out. It's on the surface. I think the lead's come off, so it's above all the rocks. And yeah, hopefully as it's my turn to hit the bites, it'll be a big one. Well, the fish is getting a bit closer now, and my good friend Gary P has got the net. So, still a way off yet, but coming slowly but surely. It's a really, really hot day today, considering it's middle of January, and back in England, there's reports of snow, freezing temperatures. We are well into 20 degrees already, I'd say. It's really, really hot. It's only early morning, and yeah, incredible conditions. And the fish, they fight really hard. They're pretty fish. This is a scaly mirror. It's not one of the biggest fish in the lake, but it's fighting really well and it looks a real stunner. She's in. Beautiful fish, landed by a beautiful man. Well, by no means the biggest fish in Lake Shearer, but again, an absolute pearler. And we're having a fantastic time. The hospitality from Carpus Paradise is fantastic. The venue's fantastic. We're getting plenty of bites from these pretty fish. And like we said on film earlier, we're gonna try the deeper water tonight with a lot more rods and see if we can tap into some of them bigger fish on our last night. The fish that I had on the first night, the 30, that came in over 20 foot of water. So that's the plan for tonight. Gonna get this little beauty back because the sun is beating down on her. And we'll see if we can get some more.
Well, here we are, this is where we're staying. This is Nick and Kelly, our hosts, and they've been absolutely fantastic, and we couldn't have asked any more of them. They brought us down breakfast, lunch, and dinner every day, which has been great food. So while I'm here now with them, I'm gonna say thanks very much to you guys. You've been absolutely brilliant, and all the lads feel the same.
No, it's been a pleasure ever.
You're very welcome.
Absolute pleasure. Absolute pleasure.
You've been fantastic. Now, if it's all right with you, Nick, I'm gonna take the opportunity now to go around the accommodation with Harry and the camera, so everyone can see what you get here, and it's absolutely great.
Absolutely.
All right, Harry, we'll move on. Let's get going. Right, starting off as you come in, you've got a toilet here and a shower. I'll shut that door. Moving into here, you've got a dining and a kitchen area with every appliance you're going to need. Washing machine, cooker, there's a microwave, defat fryer, fridge, freezer. So there's also a few baits available there. So there's pop-ups there if you need to buy those, and a few bit items of tackle. So like I say, if you're with your family and you want to use that as a dining area, it's certainly a nice area to use. Moving in here, you've got your lounge area. They've got TV there with some English channels. There's also a DVD player. If you want to bring your own DVDs, you can. And there's also a Wii console there. So if you like a bit of gaming, you've also got that. So a real nice, comfortable living area. Moving up the stairs, one thing I would say is it's incredibly cool. I think today is probably the hottest day we've been here, and it's probably about 25 degrees. And it feels like it's air-conned. It's no joke. I think it's because the sun comes up on the other side of the hill and it keeps this place really cool. So moving upstairs, got a twin bedroom out here with its own little veranda. There's a small balcony there if you want to go out there and sit in the sun. Moving over here, which is where Lou Dog and Pitchers are staying, so we might turn their bed upside down in a minute for a laugh. They're staying in here, and they've also got a little balcony area. Moving on, this is my room. Bunk beds, I've got the top one, not really. There's also a single bed there. So there's bunk beds there and a single bed there. So three in total. Then you've got, moving into here, you've got a toilet, lovely corner bath. So if you really want to have a nice soak, you can do it there. And then, actually I'm not going to show you this one, but it's a small double bed, it's Harry's and it's a mess. So we're not going to go in there. Right, and there's one last thing. Moving up the last set of stairs. You all right, guys? I'll see you in your favourite spot. This is Nick's own personal private little bar. Yeah. But he does invite people up here, so it's another nice place you can come and chill out. All right, so there's one last thing I think we need to look at, which is back down the stairs. Let's go. One last thing they've got here is one of these. It's a nice pool. Now, I've managed to get Nick away from the bar for this one, and he's decided to join me. You better take your sunglasses off, mate, because we're going in. You ready?
Let's go.
One, two, three.
Thank you, area.
Well, while Steve was away up at the villa giving you that nice little tour, it was quite a bit of chaos, and we got to experience some of the action that Gran Canaria is so famous for. And as you can see by every one of these three stunning mirrors that we've got, we've been very, very fortunate with absolute pristine, heavily scaled Canarian carp. Three bites in less than an hour, all from the far margin in the shallower water. And as we said this morning, for this evening, we're going to change tact and we're going to drop the rods in deeper water and try and see if on our last night we can't catch some of the bigger 20 and 30 pound fish that we know inhabit this lake. A couple of us are also going to change tactics slightly as well and employ a few more boilies into our free mix and boilies on our rigs, and we'll talk about that in a little bit more detail once we've got these fish back and the rods back out into position for the final night. Carper's paradise. I tend to agree, wouldn't you, Steve?
Loving it, loving
Gal?
It.
Gal?
Loving it. Paradise.
Yeah. Awesome. Just to talk you through the rig presentation that I've been using on Shearer so far. And to be honest with you, it's pretty similar to what all three of the other guys are doing. The slight variations, but the principles and the baits are pretty much identical. So starting off on the main line, I'm using 40 pound submerged braid, as is Gary and Mark. Steve's the only one out of the four of us who's using mono. Steve's the only one out of the four of us who's fished here before, so he knew he could do okay with mono, I suppose. But for us, we went for braid because we knew there was some long range fishing involved and we wanted to have better bite indication from the braid. And we also knew it's obviously a very rocky environment and weedy in the margins. So again, from abrasion resistance point of view, the braid was why we went for it. So that braided main line then goes down to a 30 pound submerged lead free leader. These are the ready tied ones. They're really simple to bring over to somewhere like Shearer, where you're getting on an aeroplane, because you can just put a couple of packs of the ready tides into a little tackle bag into your suitcase to fly over with. Like I say, these are the ready tied ones with lead clips already on. All I've done is change the standard swivel that's on the rig when you get it and put the quick change swivel on that comes in the kit. I'm using 8 ounce leads, the big old 8 ounce Klingons. Again, that's because I knew there's some long range fishing involved, and with braided mainline with no stretch, if a big wind got up, a bit of weed was drifting through, the last thing I wanted to do was have a light lead get pulled off the shelf on the far bank. So I decided to bring the 8 ounce Klingons with me. I've got a tungsten anti-tangle sleeve over the swivel of the leader. 35 pound Cortex mat in brown. Again, due to the rocky nature of the lake bed, I just wanted the strongest, most reliable components I could get away with. 35 pound Cortex, perfect. The business end, I've got a micro liner sleeve over the eye of a size 2 new prototype hook that we've been testing over the last few months at Fox. This is a wide gape straight point. It's super, super strong and incredibly sharp. Like I say, it's a size 2, which is a big hook, but we know we're fishing for carp that have extremely large mouths, and you know they're used to feeding on big food particles, and really it's not that big when you look at the size of the fish's mouth. And then on the hair, I've got a little stack rigger maize, 2 grains of real maize and then a couple of grains of plastic sweet corn. The plastic sweet corn's buoyant, so when it's on the lake bed, the hook sits flat on the bottom like so, and the stack rig sits up like that. So it's nice and visual, but as a fish comes in and sucks it, it's like a piece of spaghetti. It flies up, it's nice and streamlined to go into the mouth, then they hit the weight of that 8 ounce lead, and the size 2 hook hits home. And out of, I think I've had 8 bites on this trip and landed 8 fish. So testament to the hook and the hooking components that I'm using. So that's the rig. Pretty much similar to what I'd use in England, just a bigger lead really and a slightly bigger hook. Like I said, for the last night, I'm going to make a little bit of a tactical change. And I know Gary and Mark have also changed some of their rods over to a similar presentation, and that's gone for a big boily bottom bait with a little pop-up on top, traditional snowman style, just in the hope maybe that we can pick up a bigger fish. You know, we've been getting plenty of bites on the maize, but a fairly small average, mainly double figure carp. So for the last night, it's one of them, we're going to change the depth of water we're fishing in, and we're also going to change a few of the rods over to snowmen. So see if it makes a difference. If not, we've had a fantastic time, but you'll never know unless you try these things.
Going into the third and final night of the trip, I decided to go back to the tactics I actually started off with originally and concentrate on that slightly deeper water where them fish were, I felt, swimming through. Although most of the fish appear to be swimming around a depth of somewhere in the region of 40 feet, I did find an area where it just sloped up and it was fairly flat, around 23 feet. And that was only probably 10 yard from this kind of 40 foot depth where most of these fish were showing. So I decided to position 2 rods in this 23 foot sort of plateau. And I also increased the baiting levels as well. I had only been fishing over sort of 3 or 4 small handfuls of bait. And this time I kind of went for a couple of kilos of bait over each rod to hopefully try and draw down any fish that may perhaps be swimming around at mid water.
When you come out on a Carpers Paradise holiday, you can bring as little as much as you like, really. To be honest, they provide pretty much everything. There's bivvies here, there's bed chairs, sleeping bags, pillows, unhooking mats, pods, alarms, rods, reels. I'd advise that you just bring out a little bit of tackle if you want to keep it to a minimum. We brought some bait with us, we brought our tackle boxes, we brought our own reels. Again, really as much as anything, because we like to use our own kit where we can. Yeah, outside of that, I think alarms, I brought my own alarms, but there wasn't really a lot else I needed to bring.
For this trip, I actually brought along with me a small portable fish finder, and that really was invaluable for finding that small, shallow plateau in amongst that deeper area. Once I got to the spot I wanted, just a case of swinging the lead over the side of the boat and just feeling it down on a tight line. And the area I was looking for, I wanted to be fishing over soft ground. There is quite a lot of rocks and bumpy areas out there, and they were coming up on the fish finder all the time. It was kind of going up and down, and I wanted to be fishing over a nice, flat, smooth area where I knew the bait wouldn't tumble down the slope or get hidden amongst the rocks, and this for me was a perfect place to present the bait.
If you do run out of bait, there's bait on the site, so you can obviously purchase that from Nick. So again, you don't need to bring any. I mean, he's got boilies there, pop-ups. Yeah, pretty much what you need really to get a few bites out of here.
To our knowledge, the only other species present in Cheera is bass.
And I packed a little spinning rod, and so did Harry.
I know myself and Harry and Spurge have had a bit of fun catching them.
Harry and Mark the other day, I think they had about 8 between them, just went off on the boat for a little while, having a little spin around. And Harry had one about 4 pounds, so he's had some real fun with that. So I think, again, I brought my own little travel spinning rod and a couple of little plugs for that. But I know the guys here at Carpers Paradise have some spinning gear. So if you want to have a little go of that to pass a bit of time, if fishing's a little bit slow, then you can have a go of that as well.
On that, on the final morning when I woke up and I'd had no action through the night, I kind of thought, well, I'd thrown everything at it really. I'd tried everything and I was a little bit bemused why it hadn't paid off. And I was just sort of sat on my bed chair looking at my rod. Would it just give a couple of twitches? That sounds so wrong, doesn't it? It sounds so wrong, but that's what happened. I just saw the rod twitch a couple of times, which kind of had me sat upright. God, it gets worse, doesn't it? And then all of a sudden, them two twitches just turned into an absolute melt-off.
Well, my session hasn't really gone great. For the past 24 hours, Lewis has been reminding me that no one has ever blanked on a Carpers Paradise holiday. And he says, oh, how would it feel to be the first? You know, you'll have that accolade of being the first one ever to have blanked. I would never live it down if I did. As I'm feeling this fish grating through rocks now, that's starting to play in my mind a bit. Oh no.
Oh no. Oh.
I've kind of been saying all along I'm not interested in catching small ones, I'm only here for the big ones. I'm lying, of course, but I'm sticking to that.
They do feel heavy though, don't they? Here he is. Hey, he's a scaly mirror.
He's a proper one as well.
Hey, go on.
Yes!
Yes!
Did my big fish tactics pay off then?
Yes. Is he all right?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, Mark.
Well done.
Bait and weight.
Hey.
It's a 20, isn't it?
That's a 30. Mid-20, high 20.
Yes.
I'd say mid to high 20, mate.
How are you feeling, Mark, now?
Oh. I was sitting it out for the bigger fish, and it's paid off.
There you go, look at that.
What a stunner as well.
That's a prop on it. That is
that's the exact. What for, isn't it?
That's what I came here for. Yeah, those are the pictures I've been looking at before I came out here. A proper scaly Canarian carp. Yeah.
How things change, eh?
Yeah. Yeah.
Suicidal 1 minute, buzzing the next. Yeah. There you go.
Oh, that's awesome.
Well, ever since I was about 12 years old, I've always wanted to come and fish Lake Chira. I've been looking at photos of old-looking, scaly carp in an amazing backdrop, and it had been on my bucket list to do. And here he is, look at this. 24 pound, 14 ounce, proper Canarian scaly carp. That's one ticked off the bucket list.
Really Baltic, you know. You wouldn't want to fall in, would you? Take your breath away. He's in the way, I'm going to tie him back.
Can you... Oh, that's you.
Yeah.
That's you.
I know.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I just stripped down to do some returner shots in the water with that 24 pounder, and one of the other deep water rods ripped off. The fish is in the retainer sling and the edges, he's okay. But when I had that first fish this morning, we're all in the shade, in our fleeces, and within less than 15 minutes the sun's popped up over them hills. It's illuminated the whole of this valley. And it's gone from about 12 degrees to over 20 degrees. And it's snowing back home.
Yay.
He's all right, isn't he?
Yeah, well done.
Yeah. Oh yeah, nice one.
Well deserved.
Happy days.
On a snowman, that one.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Over boilie, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was quite a relief coming into the last day and Mark's rod ripping off in the morning. Seeing him, obviously, you know, when it's just not happening for you, it's horrible. You know, I've had a catch, and you're thinking, you know, he's worked as hard as anyone on his fishing, so you're kind of willing it to happen for him. And yeah, you can just see the relief, you know, when he eventually bagged one and it was a good fish. It was, you know, it was what he came here for. So, it was good. And it kind of, it's hard when it's happening around you not to sort of get a little bit down about it. And, you know, and I think it was affecting him quite a bit. So, yeah, it was great to see him get a fish.
Well, here we are. This is my second fish of the trip. I don't think I've ever caught a fish with such huge barbels before. Look at them, absolutely massive. Real heavy set fish as well, this. And it does look like concentrating in that slightly deeper water has paid dividends, as it's produced two of the bigger fish of the trip. So I think what I'm gonna do now, I'm gonna slip this fella back, get back out in the boat and get the rods back on them spots. I just thought I'd go through the setup that I'm using here. Although bike alarms are provided, I decided to bring my own out with me. They are my favourite alarms and they don't really take up any space or any weight in the luggage, so why not bring them? You might notice that my pod is different from what everyone else has got. Everyone else is using the pods that are provided, but I decided to bring along this new version of the Black Label pod. The one I've been testing for nearly a year now,
and it falls down so small, it literally falls down to about that big. So once again, I can put that weight in my hand luggage. It takes up virtually no weight, no space at all. So with no drama to bring it out with me. Plus, it looks so good. Even if I didn't have to use a pod, I'd probably still use it. Then I have my reels I brought, and they're loaded up with 40-pound braid. I had heard there was going to be some long-range fishing involved. I mean, I'm fishing at 300 yards here. So spooling up with that braid, there's no stretch at all, and it really does improve bite indication when fishing at great distances, because there's no stretch at all, and the indication is transmitted back virtually straight away. Speaking of indication, these are the bobbins that I'm using. I think Lewis has brought out with him, he brought out some swingers, whereas myself and Spurge, we've gone for the black label bobbins. And I've used the fat head converters on there just to give a bit more weight. And once again, because of the distance involved, I've also got two 15 gram add-on weights there. And they're attached to one of the chunky chains there as well. So yeah, bite indication of that sort of range. There's been no doubt at all it's been a bite. They've either been absolute rippers or full-on dropbacks.
Yeah, we've got a few hours left. So yeah, we're nearly at the end now. Gary's just had a fish, so that makes it, I believe, 27 now in total. And I think only two lost, I think. So two or three. So we're almost on 30 bites, and I think we will have some more yet. Generally, I'd say that the average stamp for us this time round has been quite low. We've all had good fish, though. You know, we've all had some real nice, you know, upper doubles, you know, to over 30 pound the fish have gone on this trip. So we've all had good fish. But I think what you need to remember with shearer is you don't really come here for the big fish, even though there's fish in here to over 50 pounds, you know, well over 50 pounds, I believe. You come here because it's just beautiful carp, you know. I don't think there's many places in the world you could go and catch scaly mirrors like you do at shearer. What makes it special for me is the fact that you really do feel like you're on a fishing holiday. The fishing, you can't say the fishing's hard. Physically you can make it hard if you want, you know, if you want to row your baits out all the time, then obviously it's a lot harder than casting. But what I love is the fact that we haven't had to do anything else.
Nick and Kelly really have gone out of their way to make sure we've got everything we need. We've had our food being delivered to us, like little butlers at the yard delivering food to us every morning, dinner time and evening. Anything we need, that they've been on hand there.
It's just so relaxing, and like I say, getting some winter sun as well is just so nice. And like I say, catch some stunning carp, you know, there's not really much more you'd really want. So yeah, that kind of does it for me.
So with us having to be up and out of the villa early in the morning to catch our flight, I think the plan is tonight, have a barbecue, a few beers, perhaps a dip in the pool, and I think I'm going to take on Harry at boxing on the Wii. Or in real life, I don't mind.
Well, what an absolutely perfect end to what's been a brilliant couple of days. 20 pound plus, lovely, scaly Chira carp. It's been an incredible trip. Huge thanks to Nick and Kelly at Carper's Paradise. I think we're already planning our return visit, so no doubt we'll be back here again pretty soon.
Sun, fun, and plenty of action. As far as carp fishing holidays go in the winter, they don't get any better than that in my book. Now, I'm going to hand you back to Steve, who recounts a really successful 2015 done on the most limited carp angling time.
I'm very much a short session angler. I really don't get a lot of time. Obviously people think I'm out in the bank all the time, but you know, I've got work commitments. I work full time like most people. I've got a family, and I've got a lot of other things to do tie up my time. So if I'm lucky, I'll get a night on, you know, a night a week or an evening on the bank, but I do try and get out regularly, and I kind of push myself to get out. And I think once you're in the routine of doing that and you've got kind of your kit sorted for where you need to go and where you're going to be fishing, once it's done, it's very easy to sort of grab it and go. Always make sure I'm really prepared as well, because I'm so limited for time. You know, there's certainly some waters I'll turn up and I've already got an idea of where I want to be, but it's never set in stone. I never turn up at a water and think, I'm going there, you know, that's the swim I want. I'll always give it a little bit of time just to have a quick nose round, because you never really know. I mean, I turned up on the club water for an evening this year, and the wind was absolutely hacking down one end and there was no one up there. There was four or five lads on and they were all in the back of the wind and it was like a dolphin show down the other end. So, you know, you turn up in those situations, you just got to get straight down on the fish, and it was five or six fish in an evening. When we were fishing last year, I started off where I am now actually, which is just one of the Chelmsford smaller waters. It's a good little runs water, so I started coming on in Jan and Feb, just doing the odd morning, so probably three or four mornings through those months. But it got me out of the house and it got me fishing, and I was out getting bites and just enjoying myself. Then come the spring, March, I moved back onto the Syndicate Lake. The Syndicate Lake's probably 10, 12 acres, 120 fish probably. A few sort of stockies over the last few years, but the general stamp of the fish is really good. There's probably six to eight 40s at the right time of year when they're at their best weights, and there's a few that aren't far behind as well, so it's a great water for big fish. First couple of trips, didn't go too well. Struggled. Again, they were short sessions, they were overnighters. There was one or two fish getting caught as well. And I think that was really it in March, like I say, a couple of nights, nothing happened. Got into April then. Yeah, next trip down was a blank, so that was three on the bounce, and I was starting to get a little bit twitchy about it. But yeah, I wasn't completely disheartened, and I felt I'd made a couple of mistakes, to be fair, on the first couple of trips. More on swim choice than anything. Going in the back on the back of people a couple of times, and yeah, sort of going into swims just too late, the fish aren't there anymore. But yeah, persevered with it. Fourth trip, again, just an overnighter. Yeah, it happened for me, and I caught one of the A-teamers. Well, I'm back on the Syndicate Lake in Essex, and I have had a little bit of a result. I didn't even know if I was going to do last night. It all depended on what time I finished work. It's 7:30 now in the morning. I got the rods out about 6 o'clock yesterday evening. As I said, I wasn't 100% sure even if I was going to do the night. It all depended on what time I got here. And at 5 o'clock this morning, I've got a take, and I've had a real result, and I'm absolutely over the moon and I'm buzzing. I've had a fish known as a Grand Fromage at £43.4. So it's the second biggest fish in the lake. It's one of the A-team, and it's one I can tick off the list. So absolute result. So I'm going to get her out and we'll have a look at her. I've got about an hour and I've got to be on the road. Fortunately today, I'm local. So yeah, I've got a little bit of extra time on here. So let's get her out. Well, there she is, the Grand Fromage, £43, 4 ounces. Absolutely buzzing catching this one. I wasn't even going to do last night, I was going to do the night before that, but I was too late finishing work, so it looks like fate's been on my side that I managed to get last night in. I've got about another 45 minutes and I'll be hitting the road, so just goes to show you, it's worth putting the effort in on them overnighters. So, like I say, absolutely buzzing, what a fish. Well, time to let her go. Hopefully, I'll see one of her friends later, or another day at least. See you later, girl. Yes! So I was absolutely over the moon. First fish, you know, the season out the Syndicate for me, and it's one of the biggest fish in the lake. So yeah, absolutely great then. From then, carried back on, done a couple of nights, And I was catching then, the next night on there, I was fortunate, I didn't have to go to work the next day, it was a Friday night. So I managed to stay on a little bit later, so I was on till late morning and it paid dividends. I ended up, so I was fishing from Friday evening till say probably 11 o'clock on the Saturday morning, and I had 330s. And one of them, I suppose, I don't know if you'd class it as one of the 18 members, but it's sort of close to 38 pound. Not the best looking fish in the lake, but still good sized fish. And also had two mid 30s as well, and lost a really good fish that tried to take me around the back of the island. So it was a case of holding on and the hook pulled. So a little bit unfortunate there, but you know, what a great night's fishing. I was then back on again. I think it was a couple of weeks later, so we're into May now. Yeah, it was good. I moved on, found some fish. They were all kind of down the shallows and had three fish in very quick succession. And then it kind of went quiet and I had to reposition my rods because I was really fishing in someone else's water that then turned up to fish. Turned out, I realised now why the fish were gathering down there. They actually started spawning that night and that was pretty much it. That killed the fishing on there for me. So I'd done pretty well, you know. I was on, I think at that point, I'd had seven fish and probably, I don't know, six nights, I think, something like seven nights. So I was doing really well. It can certainly be a tough lake. This year was exceptionally bad, mainly due to the fact that the weed growth this year was just unbelievable. And yeah, what it caused was the fact that there was only sort of four or five fishable swims on the lake, so it was really limited for space. I had a lot of product to test at that time. We had lots of nice little bits of terminal tackle and hooks and things to play with. So it was kind of an ideal opportunity to really move on to another water that, like I say, I was targeting a water that I wanted to catch a 30 pound coming from. It's probably 6-7 acres, I would think. Stock wise, I don't know, but it's got a good head of fish. I would have said 400 plus. So it's really has got a good head of fish. And that proved really prolific for me. Although I struggled to start with, not on numbers, I was catching numbers, but I just couldn't get through to any of the bigger fish. And I was kind of thinking the way I was approaching it was maybe wrong. But I was wading through the fish, like I say, but you know, only getting them up to like mid-20s. Anyway, I stuck with that. I certainly started doing a few evenings as well on one of the other club lakes. That is sort of days only. So again, if I was a little bit more limited for time or I needed to be somewhere the next day, work-related, you know, and it was only a case of, you know, you're going to have to do an evening, and then it was a case of going on there. And I was really enjoying that because obviously I was fitting around between a few waters as well. I then went back, so I had a bit of a break from the club lake and I went back on there. I fished a different swim. I had been targeting one area, like I say, doing the numbers, and I fished a different swim, and it was, I wasn't planning on actually fishing this swim, but I was about to walk past. I'd left my barrow there and had a walk around the lake. One of the swims I fancied was occupied, so I was planning on going down the other end, and as I come back to my barrow, I saw a fish show, and it was about the sort of range I've been fishing as a drop-off on this lake, and it was kind of in the right sort of area, so I opted to stay there. That resulted in the capture of the biggest fish in the pond that night, so I was absolutely over the moon. A fish, I believe they call it cuttail, but I'd never really thought about catching that one because I'd been told it was a bit of a loner, and you know, perhaps my approach wasn't suited to it and it comes out the edge a lot more and I'm fishing more at range. So it came as a little bit of a surprise, like I say, as much as anything, I'd gone back on there really, because if I hadn't done a night that night, I wasn't going to get any fishing that week. I think I had three other 20s and a couple of doubles as well. So it was a really, really good evening's fishing. When I turn up at a venue, I will often have some idea of where I want to go. It might just be because of the conditions, it might be because they're favourable swims anyway, but nothing is ever set in stone when I turn up. I mean, I am limited for time, so I can't spend too long thinking about it, otherwise I just won't get any fishing in. But it's like anything, as you kind of, the more you fish somewhere, the more you understand where those fish are going to be anyway. So I'll turn up, get the barrow loaded, always have a look round before I choose anywhere, you know, that I'm going to go. If there's a swim I've got in my mind anyway, I'll generally move my gear into there and then go and have a walk around the lake. Yeah, I mean, I turned up at the club lake at one point last year and it was only doing an evening. Yeah, I turned up, about four or five lads on actually. Wind hacking down one end, no one up there, dolphin show down one end, and it was a case of like, yeah, straight down there, and I'd fished a swim. I don't think I'd even ever fished before, but you know, it resulted in sort of five or six fish in an evening. So yeah, nothing's ever set in stone. Like I say, that wasn't where I was planning on going when I was heading over there. But yeah, it's hard, you know. One of the other club lakes, when I was fishing the evening there, I tend to keep the barrow loaded, even though I'm only doing sort of four. If I get 5 hours, it's a push, you know. A lot of time I'm fishing for about four, but it was more, you know, more than sort of three occasions that for the last hour and a half, I'd quite happily move swim, you know, before I had to be off the lake. If I thought, you know, that was going to be productive for me to do that, then that's what I'd do. I mean, I take a lot of gear fishing with me. Anyone that fishing with me know that, but I've kind of had to sort of scale things down, and I've had to gear bits of kit to where I'm going. And yeah, it's worked for me. Like I say, I can travel lightly with the barra, and yeah, up sticks and move. I don't tend to get everything out that, you know, I just get the bits I need. If you keep things generally packed up, it's very quick to move. So yeah, it's always an advantage. When you're doing this short, sort of style of short session angling, which most have to do, yeah, preparation's a massive part of that. Again, limited for time. I don't want to be messing around tying up rigs when I get there or anything like that. I always have loads of rigs tied. My bait's already, you know, if I'm fishing with particle, it's already prepared. I'm not mixing it up on the bank. It's all done the day before. Again, like, it kind of every second counts when you're doing that. I mean, my rods are made up. They're made up for where I'm going in advance. So if I need a different setup, it'll be ready. It won't be a case of, oh, I'm here now, I need to change that. It's done, those rods are ready to go. Even down to having hook baits on a lot of the time. You know, they'll go on the night before, they're ready to cast out. You know, if my rods are still marked from a previous session, I'm in the same swim, for example, even better. But the sticks will generally come out, the rods are quickly wrapped, hook baits are already on, and yeah, I'm fishing. Last couple of years have seen me use a lot of helicopter setups in sort of various arrangements. I've played around with it a lot the last couple of years. The reason I like it, one, it's pretty tangle proof, and I've been fishing them sort of naked style as well. I've not been using leaders. One of the beauties of a helicopter setup is it's very easy to cast it into anything. So for example, you just move the top bead. So if you're fishing into silt, I can cast into silt, and there's loads of room for error because I can move that bead to, even if I think the silt's 6 inches, I can move that bead 18 inches, 2 foot up the line, and I know I'm fishing, I know my rig's laying there. It also means even on silt, you can get away with using quite stiff rigs, and I'm quite a fan of sort of stiff style hook lengths. Again, weeds and other things. So you turn up, if you're fishing over sort of a lot of sort of dying weed or sort of low level weed, again, you slide the bead up, you know you can cast on it, you know, with a sort of balanced bait style rig, a pop up, slow sinking, your rigs always seem to sitting on it. So, and again, hard bottoms, just a case of moving the bead down nice and tight, and again, you're fishing effectively. So, for me, it's so versatile, you know, you can't do that with a leg clip arrangement, you can't do that with an inline setup. So, yeah, that's one of the main reasons, you know. Like I say, it kind of, I can adapt to any swim I suddenly drop in really quickly, fish effectively. As I said, a lot of the time I've been fishing over silt or sort of low level weed. So I've been fishing pop-ups, and I prefer to do this using a multi-rig, which was particularly suited, especially on the club lake, because at times it could be really prolific. So it meant if a hook point had gone, I could change it really quickly. I mean, as much as I still have rigs already tied up anyway, it's just a real quick way of doing it, you know, so you haven't got to go to them rigs if you don't need to. I'll also have rigs set up ready to go anyway with fresh baits on. It's another thing that I do, just really, again, it's a speed thing. Yeah, it's pretty straightforward, like most multi-rigs you'll see out there, no real variation on it. Just fishing it with a Camatex semi-stiff hook length material. Again, with the semi-stiff, if I was casting it onto anything a little bit sort of uneven, or I didn't want my rig sticking up in any strange way. So it's kind of stiff enough not to get the tangles, but at the same time, it's supple enough as well that it doesn't look strange if you do cast it onto some weed. A lot of anglers think that you can't really get a spot established when you're kind of short session angling, but I think you can definitely find spots that you can work on, and I think at certain times of the year, and depending on how much pressure there is on the lake, even if you're fishing on short sessions, you may be able to get things going at times. And then Syndicate Lake towards the back end of the year, you know, it was really weedy in the autumn still. It was probably worst actually. But I sort of stuck to swim. When I moved back on there, I went back on and I actually had a couple of nights, which was a real rarity for me. I spent the first night in this particular swim, found a couple of really nice spots. I knew one of them was out there anyway. Struggled to find anything really with a third, but yeah, anyway, I'd done the night in there, didn't have anything. Thought, well, I'll bait the spots. Plan was to try and get back next week anyway. Moved elsewhere on the lake and I actually caught. I had one, it wasn't one of the big ones. It was one of the stocky sort of 18 pound. So that was that. I was confident that there was fish in the area I'd been fishing. So next week saw me back in there. And again, I actually had two nights. So this was kind of the most fishing I was getting for the year, really. Back on these two spots, played around with the third rod again. Like I say, I never really got anything established with the third rod. And it produced, again, I don't know if you'd call it one of the A-team members, but it's certainly getting up there. At 37-13, I think it was, it's best ever weight, fish known as a prehistoric. And it's a real nice fish as well, so I'm really pleased with that. And it was fishing really hard at that time as well. So next trip saw me, again, if I could get in that swim, I was going back in there. I was now confident, like I say, there wasn't many swims to fish anyway because of the weed, but I was confident if I could get in there and get in them spots, I could probably do another bite. So it was only an overnighter, but I got in there again, had one of the kind of rare looking ones. It's a strange looking common, it looks like a big goldfish really. You see its head and you think it's a mid 30, but it went in at 26 pound on it was. But again, great to be catching, like I say, because it was fishing so hard. Next trip down saw me on for two nights. So, you know, again, long session for me. It was the first night, well, it was actually sort of coming into the next morning of the first night. So it's just getting light, gets a take, run the A-team this time. So again, over the moon, first time out of 40 pound fish known as the brown fish. Fish known as the brown fish, and 40 pound 12 ounces, first time at over 40 pound, so well pleased, absolutely made up with this one. I think I had one more session on the Syndicate after that, which was an overnighter, but unfortunately the spots didn't produce for me this time. And that was kind of it really for me there. The lake really started to sharp shop, didn't do a lot of fish all the way to the end of the year. I felt I made the most of it. Like I say, I made some mistakes early on. I think one of the key things for me last year was kind of fishing the waters at the right time, if that makes sense. So fishing the Syndicate in the spring and in the autumn, which for me are the best times of year anyway. So, you know, that paid dividends and it gave me those opportunities during those summer months to fish elsewhere and, you know, like I say, target one of the fish I wanted to catch. So planning, preparation were key, and yeah, making the most of that time on the bank, being prepared to learn and understand the waters you're fishing on, and being prepared to change. yeah, it all kind of come together. And I ended up, although I was flitting around a little bit, I really enjoyed my fishing last year. It was kind of quite a variety, and it kind of felt like I was busy fishing all the time because I was working at it. So yeah, absolutely loved last year, and hopefully this year will be even better, and I'll get a bit more time to get on the bank. I doubt it, but hopefully. Was that all right? Yeah.
What a fantastic year that was for Steve, and it's testament to the fact even with the most limited amount of time, we can still enjoy some superb results. And talking of superb results, one man who was absolutely on fire this winter was Lee Mozza Morris, and it seemed wherever he went and wherever he cast, he would catch. For this session, he's over at Orchid Lake in Oxfordshire, and the action started just a little bit sooner than I anticipated.
Right, will you join me here in Oxford at the stunning Orchid Lakes? A lake that I'd came to only a couple of weeks ago with the Bartman, and it was my first time ever here as well, and we just had a phenomenal session. For the end of January, just an incredible time. So I've come back down, it's middle of February, the weather is just horrible. It's the middle of February, you know, high pressure, it's cold, it looks bleak, it doesn't feel the one for carp fishing, but I've come out anyway, and I'm back in the Alamo swim. I've got the rods out exactly in the same spots that I'd fished last time when I was in here, and within 10 minutes I've had an absolute result. I just cannot believe it. I'm just blown away, thinking that it wasn't going to happen. It has happened, and it's a little bit of a unit as well. Now, Harry wasn't meant to be down until tomorrow, and I got on the phone to him straight away and said, look mate, where are you? And funny enough, he was driving past the lakes as I'd called him. So Harry's come down to film this little bit of a unit that's over my right shoulder here, and just incredible, can't believe it. So let's get this fish out and have a little look. Well, here he is, an absolute result for February, just incredible. 30 pound, 2 ounces this one went. I just cannot believe it. I'm almost speechless, just incredible. The fight was absolutely insane. This fish is freezing cold, and it just absolutely stripped line off of the reel from the minute I hit it, and didn't stop fighting until it went in the net. Just absolutely incredible. What a carp for the cold months of February. Yes! Yes. Yes! Yes!
Thank you. get in there, yes!
Told you, as soon as you move that rod, see, a one come in my swim and I caught it. Lee's been carving me up all weekend. Do you have a cuddle?
Yeah.
Oh.
Mate, you're going to lose this one.
I hope I don't see
you again.
No,
you've got Furby. You'll never lose another fish.
I just want to say, you've just caught two fish, right? And from the second you picked the rod up, all you've done was whinge about how you think it's going to fall off.
Yeah, because I'm scared.
Why are you scared?
The pressures of the cameras, Bart. Here we are with a fish that they call Delilah at 38 pounds something ounces. I can't even remember the ounces. I don't really care, to be honest with you. I'm just absolutely blown away by this. Right, well, Harry had left yesterday after filming that 30 pounder whilst he was passing, and he's come back this morning with all of his camera equipment, and I've had another result. Unbelievable. Last night at about 10 to 6, my left hand rod had gone again, same rod that I'd had the 30 yesterday on. And I had a 22 pound mirror, so being so early in the daytime, I just put him straight back. But this morning, the right hand rod's gone, so totally different spot. And I've had a proper unit, just again, blown away. February, freezing cold, winter fishing, and I've got something here a little bit special. There she is, all 35 pounds, 1 ounce of her. Just absolutely amazing, incredible looking carp. And for this time of year, to go anywhere in the country and catch a couple of 30s on your first night is just, wow, I'm blown away, totally blown away by it. And on a different spot as well, which is nice. So I've got a couple of spots rocking now. So, I mean, what an immense looking creature. Thank you, Orchid, and thank you, this beautiful bar of gold. Yes! Right, well, as you can see, I've taken shelter in the Alamo swim shed. The rain is coming down quite a bit now. I'm actually soaked through from putting the rods back out earlier. But it still looks good for it, I must admit. If anything, it looks better than what it did yesterday. And yesterday I had bright skies, it was bitterly cold, even there was ice in the margins. So it's looking a lot more carpier today, but the rods have been a little bit more quiet than yesterday. So whilst I'm sort of sat here in the drizzly rain, I thought I'd recap on a session 2 weeks ago that me and Mark Bartlett had in here. Quite an epic session that one was. It was actually my first time down in the swim, and or down to Orchid, and my first time in the swim, obviously. And Bartlett had got here the night before me, and straight away Mark had lost one in the swim in typical Mark Bartlett fashion. So we had we set up, got everything sorted in the swim, and basically straight away Mark started having fish, you know, from the off. I think the first night he'd had a couple of 30 pounders, he'd had a few 20s with that as well. I was just sat there not catching anything. So after Mark obviously teaching me how to fish, because I've never caught fish before, obviously, and I decided to poach his swim and started catching them. So yeah, it was as easy as that, really. But the fish did move round on the last morning into my water, luckily enough, and I managed to catch myself a 38 pounder that session, along with a few more 20s as well. So just incredible for the end of January. Just unheard of, you know, just insane. I've never had a session like that in January before, ever. So fast forward 2 weeks on, I've come back down to Orchid, and luckily enough for me, someone was leaving the swim as I arrived, so I've got back into the Alamo swim. And the beauty of having the swim mapper app is the fact that I know exactly where all them spots are out in the lake. I know where Mark's spots were, and I know where my own spots were. Basically what I'd done is you take a photo of the swim, and then with the marker sticks that you can use on the app, you can place them on your horizon markers and know exactly where you need to be aiming for. Also with them sticks, you can write down exactly how many wraps it is out to the spot. You can even write, you know, what is there on the spot, whether it's clay, whether it's silt, whether it's weedy, gravelly. So with that in mind, I've got my swim mapper app up. Straight away, I know exactly what horizon marker I need to be pointing at. I know exactly what wraps to wrap it up at. I've put a lead on quickly, chucked it out there, checked that the spot was clear, and it was just as clear as it was 2 weeks ago. So the fact that I wasn't leading around for 20 or 30 minutes and quite possibly pushing the fish out of the swim, I was just chucking out there straight away, knew exactly where the spots were, and the bites come instantly for me. I'm hoping a little bit more of the same might happen today, even though it is February and I've had a couple of 30s anyway, but that carp greed within me has kicked in. So I'm hoping and praying that the rods might sing sometime soon. Right, well, unfortunately, nothing's happened today. Still raining as well. My confidence isn't too high in the rain, but you know, it's one of them, it's carp fishing. I'm confident in the rigs and the bait that I've put out and the spots. You know, I'm happy with everything. I just think that this rain's killing it a little bit. So hopefully, if it eases off, which it's meant to do a little bit later on tonight, might bring the fish back on the feed. So yeah, you know, it's fishing, it's carp fishing at the end of the day. That's why we enjoy it. You get the highs and you get the lows. So I'm really, really hoping that something might happen tonight, and fingers crossed, we might have a fish or two. Thank you. Right, well, I've had one. The right-hand rod has gone into meltdown after explaining to Harry how epic the battles are on here. Unfortunately, like most things at night for me, it was all over a little bit too quickly. Basically, what had happened is I hit into the fish and within minutes the fish was in the net. It just swam straight towards me. So I've got a lovely scaly fish waiting in the sling for me. What I've done, I've rechucked the rod, tied a new rig on, rechucked the rod, and we've got a lovely scaly looking fish for us waiting in the sling. So let's get it out now and have a little look. That is lovely. He is lovely. All right, ye. Right, well, here he is. What an immense looking creature. Just totally blown away. He went 20 pound, 10 ounces in the end. And I caught him on a rig that's just done me a phenomenal amount of fish this winter. It's just been incredible. It's a maggot rig and I'm spotting loads of maggots over the area as well. It's not really something that I often do, but it's worked for me this time and I just couldn't be more chuffed. Fish number 4 on a February session, just blown away.
Matches early dawning. There's a reason they've been subbed out the game. Nobody calling. So I gotta succeed with my goals. Winning, not the term that's used like by them hoes. Killing mine, talking FIFA on my foes. Driven like I got a FIFA for the road.
Well, unfortunately, nothing's happened since that beautiful scaly 20 pound mirror this morning. The weather is totally different from the day yesterday. Obviously we had a lot of rain and it's now bright skies. There's quite a cold wind that's pushing in. Probably not the best sort of weather that you would want on any winter water, but for Orchid, it's perfect. This is the exact same weather as I had when I first arrived and had that 30 pounder within 10 minutes of getting here. So I'm really, really hopeful for another bite today. Only got a few more hours of this session left as well. So what I'm gonna do is just briefly run you through the rigs that have caught me a few on this session. This is the maggot rig that I've been using this session. And straight away, you'll see that it's a little bit different from the norm because there's two hooks there. Now what I've done is where you would normally tie your hair on your rig, I've actually tied on a size 14 match hook. So basically the reasons for this is I can now feed on two maggots with ease. So one goes on first and then I put my second one on as well. And what I've been using is a little mesh bag. Now, the beauty with a little mesh bag is you can now actually hook through the mesh of the bag and then pull that hook down into the plastic corn. And once that goes in there, that never ever comes out. You really, really struggle to actually get that hook out of the plastic corn. So straight away that'll trap itself onto the little mesh bag. And then that allows you to use your fishing hook straight into the mesh bag as well, and it keeps the two separated so that when you're casting it out into the lake, it will not tangle. So running through the rest of the rig, I've got a little rig ring on there. I'm using a size 5 short shank curved hook. The actual rig material is a Camotex soft in 20 pound, two blobs of putty there just to help pin that down. Right, so moving up to the lead system that I'm using, I've got a tungsten tail rubber on here. I'm using a lead clip system with a 4 ounce lead. I'm using one of the naked line tail rubbers because a lot of day ticket waters, they have either a leader band or a lead core band. So I'm using the trans khaki in 16 pound right the way through. And that tail rubber, I've never ever had tangles whilst using one. Just above the lead clip system, I've got two blobs of putty, and that just keeps that main line pinned down in the feeding area. So that's the rig that I've been using for the maggots. And the other situation on the left-hand rod, which has already done me a 30 pounder and another 20 pounder as well, is I'm using corn, maggots and hemp out on that spot. And I'm actually pouring some of the hydro wheat liquid into the spot as well. Again, putting five spots out onto the spot. If a couple of spots stray off of the spot, then I'll just make sure that five go dead in the area. So the rig that I'm using for that, exact same lead system that I'm using on the maggot rod. And the rig for it is this here. It's a D rig, and the material for it is a trans khaki in 20 pound. It's quite a stiff material, so very anti-tangle. I'm using one of the tungsten tail rubbers. I've got a bit of putty dead center of the rig to help pin that down. And coming up to the D section, I'm using a size 4 SSC hook, slightly bigger than the maggot rig, because I like that hook to be pinned down on the lake bed. And it's the perfect weight to pin down that wafter. So the wafter sits like so. It's a bright yellow PB wafter, obviously matching the corn that I'm putting out on the spot. It's a rig that's already done me two bites already, and there's still time for it to do me a third. Right, well, session's come to an end. I'm stringing it out for as long as possible. We've got the rods lying on the floor. I've been saying to Harry all day, it's gonna happen, but unfortunately it hasn't. A couple of 30 pounders and two 20 pounders in the middle of February. Well, can't grumble at that. So a huge thank you to Marsh for letting us come down to Orchid Lakes. Just an absolute epic venue. And yeah, until next time.
2 February 30s, backed up by two 20 pounders, is incredible angling. And despite probably being the biggest technophobe on the planet, I now have Swim Mapper installed on my phone, and it's already been used to great effect in my own fishing. That's all we've got time for on this DVD, and I can only hope that you've enjoyed the footage that you've seen, and more importantly, picked up a few ideas that you can incorporate into your own fishing. Now, I've already caught one carp. I'm going to get this rig back out in the lake and hopefully catch another. Until next time. Seven months, the team have been faced with a whole host of new venues and scenarios.
Now what I've done here is where you would normally tie your loop for your hair on your normal boilie fishing or any sort of fishing.
Where you would normally tie your hair.
The normal.
A little bit of pajazzle. I've seen them. I've seen.
You've seen?
Yeah. Got like diamonded. Yeah.
Why have you been looking at those?
I thought everyone did. Told you, midlife crisis.
Right, let's get you on there.
These £3 warrior rods, the action on them. I don't think I would be able to play a fish in Gran Canaria without this Fox warrior rod. And the FX 11 reel loaded with the Fox Exocet line. It's just incredible.
I've never done a four night in my life.
Two nights in this swim.
You are having me on, son.
People are loving you, Bart. We've got 30 people watching you.
No.
Loving you they
What's
are.
What's not to love about me?
Bart's fished every swim on the lake.
Said and who?
That,